So welcome all to the session on inverse functions. Now I have not named it as inverse trig functions because I'll be also touching upon inverse of a function in general. That is actually covered under the functions chapter. So relations and functions altogether is a different chapter, and under that we cover the inverse of a function. But I think it's the right time that when we talk about inverse of trigonometric function, we should know what's inverse of a function also. Okay. So let me take this as an opportunity, because sooner or later I have to do that chapter as well with you. So I'll start it today itself, inverse of a function. So what is inverse of a function? Let us understand that first. Inverse of a function. Has this concept been taken up in school?
Sir.
Yeah, Anjali, has it been taken up in school?
No, sir.
No, okay. I think NAFL has done it. So I think NPS Rajaji Nagar is yet to do it. Okay, so let me explain this concept. So all of you please listen to this very carefully. It's a very important concept, not only for competitive exams, but also for your board exams. Okay, a lot of questions are going to come on finding inverse of a given function. Okay, so as a layman, how do you understand inverse of a function? So let's say I have a function f of x. Okay, I have a function f of x. And I have another function. I'm naming it as this. Okay, now this is to be read as a symbol. It is not to be read as a operation. I'm not doing 1 by f. Okay, I'm just writing it as a name. Okay, just like a symbol. Okay, so think that I was short of alphabets. So instead of f, I chose this symbol for my function. So this is another function. Now these two functions are related in this way. So let's say functions are mathematical machines. Let's say this is a machine which I'm making in front of you. So let's say this is my machine F. Okay. What does this machine do? This machine takes in some input X and returns the output Y or F of X, whatever you want to call it, Y or F of X. Okay. And this machine, what it does, let's say this white color machine, F inverse machine. So this takes in this function that has come out from machine F. So F of X or Y, whatever you want to call it, and returns you the X back. So see the chronology over here. You have put X as an input to it. So this machine processed it and made it F of X. What did this white machine do? This white machine took the output of this previous machine, processed it and gave you X back. When there are two such machines which are doing such an activity, we call these two machines as inverses of each other. So they would be called as inverses of each other. Okay, a very layman definition, a very, very layman definition. Fine. To give you an example for the same, let's say there's a machine f e to the power x. Okay. And there's another machine, ln x. Now I claim that these two machines are inverses of each other. Why? For the simple reason, let's say in this machine, if I put in 2, this machine will give me e square, isn't it? Okay, sorry, let me write in yellow because yellow is the original machine. So sorry for that. So let's say in this machine, if I put 2, I'll get 2 e square from this machine. So when you put e square in this f inverse machine, okay, this machine is going to give you ln of e square. Ln of e square is what? Ln of e square is actually a 2. So you had put 2 here, you got e square. If you put e square here, you got a 2. So these two machines would be inverses of each other. So these two machines would be inverses of each other. Is this fine? In short, what I'm trying to say is that if your f works from A to B, okay, then f inverse will work from B to A, where B must be the range of the function. Where B must be the range of the function. So range of f becomes the domain of f inverse, and domain of f becomes the range of f inverse, and vice versa. Okay, so we already know this is domain, so I did not write it, but let me write it for clarity. Okay, so domain of f, let me write it over here. Domain of f becomes the range of f inverse, and range of F becomes the domain of F inverse. Okay, but this is a very, very superficial explanation of what is inverse of a function mean. I'll go into deep inside the concept and discuss a lot of nitty-gritties about the concept. Meanwhile, any doubt regarding what do you understand from an inverse of a function, please let me know. Any case or in case of any doubt or any concern, please highlight over here. Is it fine? No problem. Good afternoon, Anjali. Good afternoon to everybody who has joined in. And all the best for tomorrow's school. There may be some initial technical challenges. So a couple of things. There may be some drop of data and all. So you may be missing out hearing something from the teacher. So ensure that you are, you know, asking a lot of questions there. Secondly, get to know the tool very well, because MS Team is a new team, a new platform for most of you, because we have been conducting classes mostly on Zoom and Moxtra. So all the best for tomorrow's session. Okay. Any questions? Now, one important question that arises in our mind is, are all functions invertible? Can I find inverse of every function on this earth? Yes,
sir. Could you repeat? My connection just went.
Yeah, this is what will happen tomorrow also. Yeah. Repeat from where?
So domain and range.
Yeah. Okay. So see what happens. F works in some on some input. Okay. And gives you some output, right? So its inverse will work on the output of F and will give you the input of F back. So if F works from A to B, where A is the domain and B is the range, not the codomain, B is the range, then F inverse will work with B as the domain and A as the range. So this will be the domain of F inverse and this will be the range of F inverse. So the connection here between F and F inverse, which is very much evident, is that domain of F is the range of its inverse and range of F is the domain of its inverse and vice versa. Is this fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is very important. Now the next thing which we are about to discuss is, are every functions invertible? Can I find inverse of every function? Right? The answer to that is no. So what type of functions are invertible? So remember, if f of x is invertible, it means f of x is a bijective function. So only bijective function, also called as bijection, also called as aka as bijection. So only bijections are invertible. Now you must be wondering, what is this new word bijections? I have not heard about it in my functions chapter last year. Yes, it's a new word for you. So I'll be now talking about, you know, bijections. And in course of explaining bijections, there would be many other new terms that will come your way. So slowly we'll talk about those terms as well. So what's a bijective function? What's a bijective function? Now functions which are both 1-1 and onto, right? So bijective function is basically the one which is both 1-1 and onto. Okay, again, these two words are new to you. What is 1-1? What is onto? What is this, you know, already ready-made term that sir is using today? Don't worry, we'll explain, we'll go into deep details of each one of these today. 1-1 means injective functions, also called as injections. It's a combination of inject and functions, so injections. And onto means surjections or surjective functions. So these are some technical terms which you need to know. So functions which are both injective and surjective are called bijective. Now what is injective? What is surjective? Let me go into details of this. Okay. So let me start today's proceeding with explaining you what's a 1-1 function. Now we are entering into a part of your CBSE curriculum which talks about types of functions. So let me give you a header to this types of function. Types of functions. So functions are normally categorized into two complementary sections. One is called one-one function, another is called many-one function. So one-one and many-one. Now, what are these one-one and many-one functions? As the name itself suggests, there is a one-to-one correspondence in case of a one-one function. Okay, definition-wise, every image, let me define it for you. When a function is one-one, remember every image. What are images? Images are your elements of the range. Right? So every image, that means whatever elements are there as a part of your range under this mapping, those every image will have a unique pre-image. A unique pre-image. Okay? Let me give you a dummy arrow diagram for it. So let's say there is a set A and there is a set B. And let's say this is a function. Your function maps A, B, C to 1, 2, 3, 4. And the mapping goes like this. A maps to 1, B maps to 2, C maps to 3. So you can see that 1, 2, 3 are your images under this mapping, right? And A, B, C are their corresponding pre-images, correct? So you can see every image has come from a unique pre-image. That means no two pre-images are mapping to the same image. Correct? So when no two pre-images are mapping to the same image, we call such a function as one-one function. However, let me tell you, it is allowed for a function to have two pre-images mapping to the same image. Correct? But in a function, it is not allowed to have one pre-image mapping to multiple images. Correct? So now in this function, in a one-one function, there's one more restriction that every image should have a unique pre-image. Of course, vice versa is always true because then only it will be a function. Right? Okay? So this is a typical arrow diagram that suggests you a one-one function. Okay, to give you some examples of one-one function, let's say I have a function from real numbers to real numbers. I can take an example of, let's say, 2x plus 3, correct? This is an example of a one-one function. That means every output will come from a unique input. But let's say if I put a 5 for it, 5 will come only from 1. It cannot come from any other value, correct? So this is an example of a one-one function. Is it clear what's a one-one function, everybody? Is this clear? Any questions? Okay, no question? Okay. So how do you define a many-one function then? In many-one function, at least one image has more than one pre-image. That means out of the images, there exists at least one image which is coming from more than one pre-image. So a typical arrow diagram here would look like this. Let me just make a set A and set B. Okay, and this is a mapping. So let's say a mapping is like this. So this has got A, B, C. This has got 1, 2, 3, 4. And let's say the mapping goes like A is mapping to 1, B is mapping to 2, C is also mapping to 2. Okay? So this will be a case of a many-one function. Many to one, as the name itself suggests. Now, what are the examples for this? So I can take an example of, let's say, from R to R, x squared. Okay, in x square, you would realize that if you just make a rough arrow diagram, there would be two pre-images which will map to the same image. For example, 2 square and minus 2 square will give you the same answer, isn't it? Same way, 3 and minus 3 will give you 9. 4 and minus 4 will give you 16. So I'm just giving you a rough example. So this is a case where at least one pre-image, at least one image has more than one pre-images. Has more than one pre-images. Is this fine? Now, many people I have seen here, they actually decide on one one or many one by looking at the definition of the function. This is very wrong. Now, the same function, as you can see, if I change my domain to R plus, okay, the very same function, x square. Now you would realize that if you have R plus, then this 4 can only come from 2. Correct? 9 can only come from 3. 16 can only come from 4. Are you getting my point? So in this case, you would realize this function is a 1-1 function. So here it was an example of a many one. And the very same function started behaving as 1-1 now when I made a small modification to its domain. So dear students, this is very important for us to understand that never pass a judgment on the function by looking at its definition. Many people, oh, x square, many one. Oh, x to the power 4, many one. Oh, sine x, many one. No, don't pass the judgment unless until you have a concrete idea about its domain. So you can curtail your domain to make a many one function as 1-1 also. Right? So domain plays a very important part in decision of 1-1 function or many one function. Is this idea clear? Any questions here? Okay. So before we move on to any other thing, how to identify a 1-1 function and all, I would like to ask you all a question. The question is very simple. Question is, in fact, this is a theory that we need to keep in mind. So let's say there is a set A which has got n elements and there's a set B which has got r elements. Fine? Okay. My question here is, how many 1-1 mappings are possible from set A to set B? How many 1-1 mappings are possible or 1-1 functions are possible from set A to set B? I would like you to put the answer in the chat box. By the way, everybody knows total number of functions possible. How many total functions are possible from set A to set B? Shankin, total number of functions. Okay, let me start from back. Total number of relations possible. So let me go back a little bit. How many total number of relations are possible? 2 to the power nr. Correct? Absolutely, Siddhartha. How many functions are possible? R to the power n. R to the power n. Remember I told you it's number of elements in the codomain raised to the power of number of elements in the domain. Fine. This you should never forget. Very important. Okay. So if A1 has got till n elements, B1 has got B1, B2, till BR, how many 1-1 mappings are possible? How many 1-1 mappings are possible? Take a call. Let it be wrong. No worries. Take a call. Okay. Anjali says dash. I'll not tell what is her answer. Anybody else? 53, Sudha. Very good. Okay. Ashish. Nice. A, where is A, ma? It's only R and N here. Ashish.
So the last number, sir. Okay.
Last number.
An, sir.
An. Oh, the last number you're saying. That will determine how many 1-1 functions are there. Okay. Okay, so let me ask you this question in a slightly simpler format. If your R is less than N, how many 1-1 functions are possible? Now, this is not a very difficult question. You can actually take a dummy example. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a scenario where R is less than N. Okay, so A and B. Okay, I'll take three elements here, A, B, C, and I'll take two elements here. So R is less than N, correct? So R is 2 and N is 3, correct? How many 1-1 functions are possible? Now see, let me start a mapping. So A maps to 1, let's say. Okay, now B cannot map to 1, else it will not be a 1-1 mapping. So B has to map to 2, poor fellow. Okay, now I cannot leave C behind, because if I leave C behind, it will not be called a function only. Correct. So C has to either map to 1 or has to map to 2. So the moment you map C to 1 or 2, my dear, what do you realize? You will not be able to make any 1-1 function. So Shankin is absolutely correct. So zilch. No 1-1 function will be formed if R is less than N. Okay. Now what about when R is equal to N? Let's say when R is equal to N. So let me take a case. R is equal to N. So let me make A and B as two dummy sets. Let me take three elements here, A, B, C. Let me take 1, 2, 3. So A, let's start mapping for A. A has got three options. Okay, so A can map to any one of them. Let's say A goes and maps to 2. So A has got three options. B has got, now B cannot go to 2. So B has got 1 and 3 only. So two options for B. Okay, so let's say B goes and maps to 1. So C will have only one option. Whichever is left, it has to go with it. Correct? So the total number of functions that could be formed in this case is 3 factorial. Correct? If you scale this up and say both R and N are equal, then your answer will either be N factorial or R factorial, because both are same. Okay? Don't take this lightly, because this may be a question in your school exams also. Fine. Let us take the last case now, when your R is greater than N. Okay. So let me make a dummy diagram for this also, when R is greater than N. So let's say there's a set A and there's a set B. Okay. And let's say A has got A, B, C, and this has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Now, how many options A has? How many options A has? A will have 5 options. It can, you know, go and map to any one of the 5. So let's say A goes and maps to 3. Okay. How many options will B have now? Of course, B cannot choose 3 now. It has 4 other options to be chosen from. So B has 4 options. So let's say B goes and it's 2. Okay. So C will have 1, 2, 3, 4 options. So C will have 4 options. Okay. I'm so sorry. It'll have 3 options. My bad. Okay. So your total number of cases or total number of 1-1 functions that can form is basically 5 into 4 into 3, which is actually 5 factorial by 2 factorial, right? 2 is 5 minus 3 factorial, right? Okay. This reminds me of the formula 5P3. So in this case, you will have R, P, N number of 1-1 functions. Is this fine, dear students? So whenever such a case arises, you take a miniature scenario and just try to scale it up. Getting my point? Now, you may combine the last two scenario, because when R and N are equal, even R, P, R is R factorial. So you may combine this formula to be 0 when R is less than N, and RPN when R is greater than equal to N. Please remember this. This will help you save time in your exam also. Any questions here, anybody? Any questions here? Okay. This is clear. How many 1-1 functions? Fine. Now, if a function is defined for me, how do we identify a 1-1 function? So the next concept that we are going to discuss with you is identification of 1-1 function. Identification of 1-1 function. Okay. Now we normally identify a 1-1 function in three ways. Any one of the three ways could be used. The first method is your graphical method. Graphical method. Okay. Now, how do you identify a function from its graphical method? What do you think would be a method? Let's say if you know a graph of a function, from the graph, how will you identify whether it's 1-1 or not a 1-1? Any idea? NAFL people don't respond. I want NPS RNA to respond. NAFLers, please don't respond. Only NPS RNR people to respond. If graph of a function is known, okay, let's say I make a graph like this. Zoom. Okay. Is this graph a graph of a 1-1 function? Yes or no? If no, why no, not? Sir. No. Okay. So Shaumik is saying no. Why not, Shaumik?
Sir, because at for a 1-1 function, if we draw a horizontal line and anywhere in the graph, it should intersect the curve only at a single point.
Absolutely. So Sahana also has an explanation. If it is only one coordinate for the same x, then it will be 1-1 function. Right, Sahana? That is very well stated. So how do you, you know, implement that statement of yours in this case? So as Shaumik rightly pointed, if I draw a horizontal line, okay, horizontal line means line parallel to the x-axis, okay, any horizontal line. Now, you should always draw it to scrutinize the function. Don't draw a horizontal line here, okay? We need to scrutinize the function. You don't have to save the function, right? There is no friendship between you and the function. You have to scrutinize it. If such a line cuts the function at more than one point, then it will not be a 1-1 function. The reason being, it is clearly saying that a particular output, let's say an output y, okay, it is coming from three separate inputs, x1, x2, and x3. That means if you make a arrow diagram from it, okay, set A is your domain, set B is your, you know, codomain, then you would realize that there would be three such inputs in this case, which will map to the same output. So this is definitely not a 1-1 function, correct? So what we say is that if a function has to be 1-1, it should satisfy a horizontal line test. Now don't get confused with vertical line test. Vertical line test is there to see whether a relation is function or not, right? Every function must satisfy a vertical line test. But those functions which also satisfy a horizontal line test, those would be called as 1-1 function or injective functions. Okay. So here the idea is, I'll write it down, this is not a 1-1 function. So the idea is, a 1-1 function will always pass the horizontal line test. And what is the horizontal line test? Let me write it here. 1-1 function satisfies horizontal line test. And what is this test? This test is any horizontal line will cut the function only at one point. Okay. So as I told you, don't try to save the function. Don't draw a line here and say, oh, sir, it is cutting only at one point here. No, you have to scrutinize the function. That's why I wrote any horizontal line will cut the function only at one point. Now, this nature comes from the fact that 1-1 functions are known to be monotonic. The reason being, 1-1 functions are known to be, 1-1 functions are known to be monotonic. Are monotonic. What is monotonic? Monotonic means it is either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. It cannot show you both the characteristics. Okay, so I'll write it down here in bracket. It is either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing. Or strictly decreasing. They will not be stagnated, or they will not show you rise and fall both simultaneously. Either it will, what is strictly increasing? Let me just, you know, show you through some diagrams. Strictly increasing means the function will either be like growing like this, right? Or it will be growing like this, or it will be growing like this. This is called strictly increasing cases. So in any of these cases, if you draw a horizontal line, they are going to cut the function only at one point. Getting my point? Strictly decreasing means what? Strictly decreasing means it is only decreasing in this domain. So either it is falling like this. Okay, let me draw it in yellow. Falling like this, or falling like this, or falling like this. Okay, so any horizontal line that you draw in the function will end up cutting it only at one point. Okay, it is not like the parabolic function that we had seen in x square. So if it is like this, the moment you draw a horizontal line, it will cut at two points. So this is not a case of a 1-1 function. Is this okay? Understood? Now, what is this monotonic and all word use here? This is something which is coming up for you in application of derivatives chapter. So don't worry, we'll do one complete chapter only on this monotonic nature of functions, or monotonicity, what we call it. Any question, anybody? Clear?
Yes.
Vibhav has a question. Yes, Vibhav, all linear functions are 1-1 functions. All linear functions, y is equal to any linear polynomial is a 1-1 function. Is that what you wanted to ask, Vibhav? Okay. Now, it would be wrong to say any quadratic function is not 1-1. It would be wrong to say that, because as I've already told you, it is in the hands of the domain. It is in the hands of the domain. So even I can make quadratic functions 1-1 if I want to. I can make cubic functions if I 1-1 if I want to. So never judge a function on its, you know, degree, that, oh, it's a cubic, it must take turn. It's a quadratic, it must have, you know, a U shape. No, it is not. It is not, you know, the shape. It is basically, where are you looking, in which interval of x are you looking at the function? Okay, so the idea is, if you don't allow the function to take a turn somewhere, it will be 1-1. The moment you allow it to take a turn somewhere, it will lose its 1-1 nature. Okay, so the word here is turn. It should not have any turning point. Is the idea clear? So it should be monotonic in nature. Monotonic means either strictly increasing or strictly decreasing in its domain. Good enough? Okay. So what is the next test? Next test is the uniqueness test. This is what I call as the uniqueness test. Uniqueness test. Now this test is basically a test based on contradiction. Okay. So what do we do? Let's say I have a function defined from domain to codomain. Okay, I'm not writing A and B. I'm just, you know, writing straight away as domain and codomain. Okay. And the function is defined as something, whatever. Okay. So this is given to you. And they ask you, test whether this function is a 1-1 function or not. And let's say you are not in a position to sketch its graph, because probably the graph is too complicated to sketch. So what can you do in such a test? So we'll say, let x1 and x2 be two inputs from the domain of the function, such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. Okay, so this is your initial assumption. This is your initial assumption while solving the question. So you're assuming that, let there be two separate inputs which give me the same output. Let there be two separate inputs which gives me the same output. Correct? And let's say by using this assumption, dot, 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 you realize x1 is equal to x2 is the only possibility. X1 equal to x2 is the only possibility. Then what do you comment on this function? Then this function will be a 1-1 function in that case. Now this word only possibility is very important. Why I'm saying only possibility? Because this will always be a possibility. See, try to understand. When you are comparing f of x1 to f of x2, when you are equating these two, it is very obvious that x1 equal to x2 will satisfy this equation. Even a blind person can tell that, boss, if x1 and x2 are equal, this relationship will be true. So this will always appear as your solution. That doesn't mean you will blindly say that it is 1-1 function. But if that possibility is the only possibility, that means whatever other possibilities you are getting, if you are able to negate those possibilities or say, okay, this that cannot happen, then you can say that the function is a 1-1 function. I'll take a simple example to illustrate this. Okay, very simple example. Let's say I define a function from R to R as x square, our same old parabola. Okay, but now I'm dealing with two examples containing x square, one having R to R and the other having R plus 2R. Okay, same function in both of them. Okay, the only difference is in their respective domains. So this is all real numbers, this is only positive real numbers, right? Now, here if you see, let me apply my uniqueness test over here. So let's say there are two inputs, x1 and x2, coming from the domain of the function, such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. Okay, that is, you are saying x1 square is equal to x2 square, correct? So f of x1 is x1 square, f of x2 is x2 square. Okay, so this is my initial assumption. Fine. Now, dear students, a very sincere request to all of you, do not cancel out square square. Please. Okay, now you are matured enough not to do that. Okay, if you do that, you are losing on informations. Okay, canceling out powers means loss of information. Fine. So do not do that. So what is the right way to solve it? Bring one of them to the other side. So you write it like this. Okay. Now this is factorizable as x1 minus x2 and x1 plus x2. So this will give me two possibilities. One is x1 minus x2 is equal to zero. That is number one possibility. And number two possibility is x1 plus x2 is equal to 0. Okay. In other words, you are getting one of them as x1 equal to x2 and the other one is x1 is equal to negative x2. Correct. So as I told you, x1 equal to x2 will definitely come out from your, you know, this relation, right? As I told you, it will always come out from this. But is this the only possibility? No. There is one more possibility arising. Can you negate it? Can you say this is not possible? Can you invalidate this condition? Unfortunately, no. There could be two real numbers which are negative of each other and can give you the same squares. For example, 4 can be obtained from 2 square also and minus 2 square also. Right? So this is telling you that, boss, that this condition is possible when x1 is equal to x2. That is number one. But it is also possible when x1 is negative of x2. Right? So there could be two separate inputs which can give you the same output. So in this case, we have to say this function is not 1-1. In other words, it is many one. Right? Are you getting it? So this is not the only possibility. This is also possible along with it. Many students have seen making a mistake. Oh, I got x1 equal to x2, so 1-1. No, that will always come out. Don't worry about it. You should be worrying about negating the other possibilities. Okay. Or even the other possibility should give you x1 equal to x2. But unfortunately, it is not happening in this case. So I have to conclude here that x square under this definition from R to R is a many one function. Okay, you can further emphasize it with a diagram. Now, my dear students, let me tell you one more thing, that when you are trying to prove this in exams, school exams, please do not just draw a graph and tell your teacher, see, it is cutting at more than one point, so it is not 1-1. Your teacher will give you zero for it. Okay, graph and all is good for your competitive exams, not to be used for school exams. If at all you are using it, it is to be like a supplement. It is to be like a support for your answer. Do not just solve a question by using graphs. You can always use graphs to support your answer. That is fine. Okay. Now, let me show you the other case. Now, here, I'll start with the same proceeding. Let x1 and x2 come from R plus. That is the domain of the function. Such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. That means you're saying x1 square is equal to x2 square. Okay. Or same thing, same approach. I mean, there's no difference in the approach. So you'll end up getting x1 minus x2, x1 plus x2 equal to 0. Okay. That again gives you two possibilities. Either this is 0. Okay. Or x1 plus x2 is equal to 0. So this gives you x1 equal to x2 as one case. Another case is x1 is equal to negative x2. No difference in it. But now I can say with surety that this is not possible. Why it is not possible? Because two positive real numbers cannot be negative of each other. Have you ever seen any two positive real numbers which are negative of each other? It's not possible, right? So in the light of the domain, you are able to negate the other scenario. That means this is the only possibility, my dear friends. This is my only possibility. And if this is the only possibility, then you can say, yes, this function is a 1-1 function. This function is a 1-1 function. And graphically also, you can support it. So when you draw x square, you will only draw the part which is on R plus side. You'll only draw the part which is on the R plus side. Getting my point? So if you draw any horizontal line, it will only cut at one point. It cannot cut it at more than one point. And hence, it is a 1-1 function. So don't go by the definition. Go by its domain along with the definition. Is the idea clear how it works? So this is something which is very important. And this is what your school will also ask you. Important for your school. Any question, any doubt, please stop me. Okay, let's have a quick question on this. I think NAFLers would be knowing it. So apply uniqueness test to prove that x cube is a 1-1 function. Okay, apply uniqueness test to prove that x cube is a 1-1 function. Now your school may not use the word uniqueness test. They will say prove that it is a 1-1 function. So you have to only apply the uniqueness test. So prove that f of x is a 1-1 function. Or it's an injection. Everybody please attempt this. I'm giving you 1 minute. See, zero. Yeah, I could have included zero also. That won't make a difference. But since I said R plus, that's why I didn't include zero. Okay, with zero also, it will be 1-1. Anjali. Yes, exponential functions are 1-1, Siddhartha. Exponential functions are 1-1. Logarithmic functions are 1-1.
Okay.
Okay. Done? Just type done once you're done. Done. Tirpan is done. Okay. Pratham is done. Ayush is done. Aditya C is done. Duni. Okay. Atharv is done. Aditya Manjunath is done. Okay. So most of you have done it. So let me discuss this with you. Now, if I apply the uniqueness test, I'll say let there be two inputs X1 and X2 belonging to R. Okay, such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. Okay, that is, you're saying x1 cube is equal to x2 cube. Now again, for God's sake, do not cancel out the powers. The right way to solve this is bring it to one side, factorize it. Factorize it like this. Okay, AQ minus BQ formula, everybody knows in Bangalore. So this will give me two possibilities. X1 minus X2 is equal to zero. So as I told you, X1 minus X2 will pakka come. Okay, so don't make a judgment over here, right? Now, other than this, you also get X1 square plus X1 X2 plus X2 square. Correct? Is this fine? Okay, now how do you show that? Number one, it's not possible, or if it is possible, that it can only be possible when x1 and x2 are equal to each other and equal to zero each. Now there are several ways to do it. You can make a perfect square from it like this: x1 plus half x2 the whole square plus 3/4 x2 square. And you can say that since everything is a perfect square, the only thing that will make it zero is when x1 and x2 both are equal to zero each, which anyways gives you x1 equal to x2 as your, you know, final condition. Correct? Some people would like to multiply with a 2. Another approach is multiply with a 2. Okay? And write it as x1 plus x2 the whole square plus x1 square x2 square. So as you can see here, everything is a perfect square. So if they have to be zero individually, each one of them has to be zero, which will ultimately lead to x1 equal to x2 equal to zero. So what you see is x1 equal to x2 is the only thing that is coming out from here. Okay, even if you take this possibility or this possibility, ultimately the end result is x1 equal to x2. One more school of approach is, I don't know whether you remember your complex numbers. This can actually be factorized as x1 minus x2 times x1 minus omega square x2. What is omega here? Omega is the complex cube root of unity, minus half plus I root 3/2. Hope you remember this. I told you that this can be factorized. Okay. So if this is possible, that means you're saying a real number could be written as a complex number times real number, right? So if this is real, and this is complex, this scenario can never arise until unless x1 and x2 both are zero each. Okay? Neither will this situation arise till your x1 and x2 are equal to zero each. Okay, so whatever approach you take, ultimately you end up getting x1 equal to x2 only. Okay, so by all these, we can say that yes, this function, conclusion is yes, x cube function under the definition of real to real is a 1-1 function. So this function is a 1-1 function. Any questions here? Anybody? Any question, any concern, any doubt? Try one more. Can you all see this question? So there's a function defined from R to R as, it's a rational function, x square plus 4x plus 7 upon x square plus x plus 1 is f of x 1, 1. Done, very good. Anybody else? So I can see okay. Is this so difficult? Now, sketching this would be slightly difficult because it's not a polynomial or something, it's a rational function. Okay, so you have to take care of all those asymptotes kind of a scenario. So what we'll do is, I'll first make my life easy by, you know, writing this term like this. So numerator, I'll break it up as x square plus x plus 1 plus 3x plus 6. Okay. Something like this. Fine. Now I'll start my proceeding. Let me apply the uniqueness test. Let's say x1 and x2 belongs to real numbers, okay, such that f of x1 is equal to f of x2. Okay, now the benefit of doing here is that the moment you put f of x1 and f of x2 and equate, you can safely cancel out 1 and 3. Okay, so it slightly reduces the complexity of the scenario. Now cross multiply. So x1 plus 2 times x2 square plus x2 plus 1 is equal to x2 plus 2 times x1 square plus x1 plus 1. Fine. Now let me bring everything to one side. So x1, x2 square. And from this side, I'll get x1 square, x2. Okay. I will also have x1 minus x2, and I will have 2x2 square minus 2x1 square, and I will have one more term, 2x2 minus x1. Okay, so this will be zero. Now you can see, you can easily pull out x1 minus x2 from all the terms. For example, from here I can pull x1 minus x2 and along with a minus x1 x2. From these two terms, I can write it as minus x1 minus x2, and this term here would be minus 2x1 minus x2 x1 plus x2. Okay, so if I pull out x1 minus x2, which definitely would come as my answer, remember I told you x1 minus x2 will have to come as your one of your solutions. Okay, the other solution would be minus 2x1 plus x2. Okay, minus x1, x2, and a minus 1. Okay, so there are two possibilities arising. Either x1 minus x2 is 0, that is number one possibility. And the other possibility is the other factor is 0, which I'm writing as without a negative sign. So 2x1, 2x2 plus 1 equal to 0. Now, is there anything that you can do to rule this out? Or are you able to find an example of x1 not equal to x2 which satisfies this condition? If you're able to do the latter, that means you can claim it is not a one-one function. This is very interesting, my dear. All of you, please listen to this. Disproving something one-one is very easy. So if you want to prove it's not one-one, I think a simple example will suffice. So if you're able to come an example, so if you're able to cite an example where x1 and x2 are not equal and this condition is fulfilled, that means you have said that there is another possibility other than x1 equal to x2 for which f of x1 and f of x2 can be equal. And in that case, you are saying that this function is many one. In that case, you're saying that the function is many one. Okay, so to prove many one, it is sufficient to cite an example like this. Else, if you want to prove this cannot happen, you have to give me a generic proof that this cannot happen. Okay, so Shankin has given a proof that if you take x1 as 1 and x2 as minus 1, okay, let me do that. So this will become a minus 1, this will become a 2, this will become a minus 2 plus 1. It's becoming 0. Absolutely, Shankin is very, very correct. So Shankin has given an example where if x1 is 1 and x2 is minus 1, then this condition is going to hold true. That means f of 1 and f of minus 1 will give you the same output. Okay, can you verify this here itself? F of 1 gives me 1 plus 4 plus 7 by 1 plus 1 plus 1, which if I'm not mistaken is 4. And f of minus 1 is 1 minus 4 plus 7 by 1 minus 1 plus 1. Right? How much is this? This is also 4. This is also 4. So yes. So many people say, sir, could we do this in the beginning of the question itself? Yes, why not? But you have to have that vision. You have to have that, power. You can say, you have to think ahead of time to prove it. Okay. So at this stage or at the initial stage, if you are able to cite an example where x1 and x2 are not equal and meets this condition, that means this condition can also hold good. So this is not the only possibility. This is not the only possibility. Are you able to understand the nitty-gritty of things over here? And hence this function is many one function. Okay. Now there can be so many examples. I can give x1 equal to, let's say, minus half and x2 equal to 0. Right? So if I put x2 is 0, then this and this will go for a toss and this will become minus 1. Minus 1 plus 1 will be 0. So another example. This could be another example. Is it understood? Okay, so this function is not a one-one function, it's a many-one function. Any question, any concerns, please ask me.
And we'll get a set of solutions from this equation, sir, of x1 and x2.
Yes, so here if you can get a, this is basically a two variable single equation. So if you're able to find two, any two real numbers, any two numbers belonging to the domain of the function, which are different from each other and makes the second condition true, then you have to abandon the fact that it is a one-one function. You have to accept it is a many-one function. Right, Tripan?
Yes. Yes, sir, but then we'll get a set of solutions from this one equation, sir.
Yeah.
Like supposing we have some solvable equation and we get some set of solutions, then will that be the number of times the graph will turn of the original function?
No, actually we cannot say that. For example, let's say if you have x1 is equal to minus x2 coming in case of a quadratic equation, right? Okay, so 2 and minus 2 will give you the same input, correct? 4 and minus 4 will give you the same, sorry, output.
Yes.
4 and minus 4 will give you the same output. 6 and minus, so that doesn't mean it is going to turn that many times. It is only turning once. Correct? So this is a relationship. This is a relationship between the two inputs so that the output becomes the same. Getting my point? It doesn't signify how many times it is turned. Okay. Now coming to the last test, the third test, coming to the last test, that is called the calculus test. This test is basically a advanced version of the first test, where I told you a monotonic function is basically a one-one function. A monotonic function is basically a one-one function. So if a function is always increasing, either like this or like this or like this, right? What will happen at any point if you draw a tangent? At any point of this function, you draw a tangent. Okay, doesn't matter whether it is this case, or whether it is this case. You would realize that for all these situations, your derivative of the function will always be greater than zero for all x belonging to the domain of the function. Correct? And if the function is strictly decreasing, let me write it as strictly increasing. If a function is strictly decreasing, let's say it decreases like this, or it decreases like this, or whether it decreases like this, okay? You would realize that at any point of the function, if you draw the tangent, your slope of the tangent will always be negative for all x belonging to the domain of the function. So listen to what this test says. This test says that if the function derivative is either positive or negative, but not both, that means this or is exclusive or, right? So either your derivative of the function is positive or this or is exclusive or. Exclusive or means both cannot happen together, okay? Or the derivative of the function is negative for all x belonging to the domain of the function, then your function will be a one-one function. So a one-one function will satisfy this characteristic. Okay. Now in some cases, you will have to include zero also, but this is to be used with lot of discretion. So I'm putting it with dotted this thing. Why? It's because you will be tricked in such functions like x cube graph, okay? You know that at zero, the slope is zero, right? The slope of the tangent at x cube is zero, but it is a 1-1 function, right? So you'll say it is not the derivative is zero, so it should not be a 1-1. Will you say that? No, that would be wrong to say. So in the case of x cube, you have to include the slope of the tangent being zero also, but that cannot be included blindly because there may be a function which will be something like this. Let's say it went and then it stayed flat. Okay. If it stayed flat, means any point here, if you choose, the tangent would be 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is not a 1-1 function, but this is a 1-1 function. Okay. So inclusion of 0 has to be, you know, done with lot of discretion, lot of thought upon manner. Are you getting this point? Now this test, please do not use it now when your school reopens and let's say your teacher teaches you this chapter. Do not try to solve questions by use of calculus method, because this is something which you probably will learn in your application of derivatives chapter. So she might not honor this, but get a confirmation from her. Is this fine? Any question here? So three tests we saw: horizontal line test, uniqueness test, and the last one, the calculus test. Fine. To show an example of how calculus test works, so let us say if I talk about under this definition, is your x square function a 1-1 function? So if you differentiate this, you'll end up getting 2x. And since your x belongs to R plus, f dash x will always be positive, right? If this is always positive or always negative, not both, it should not show you both the characteristic, because if it shows both the characteristics, that means it is rising somewhere and it is falling somewhere. The moment rising and falling both are happening, it'll be cut by a horizontal line at more than one point. So this will not be a 1-1 function, right? So in this case, you will say, since the slope is always positive in the domain of the function, yes, it is a 1-1 function. Right? But if you had only R, then 2x could be both positive and negative, depending upon whether your x is positive or negative. So in that case, it would be a many 1 function. Idea is clear? Now, many one, I don't have to speak much about it, because many one is basically the complementary of 1-1. It is the complementary of 1-1. So what is not 1-1 is many one. Okay, so by default, if a function is not 1-1, it is many one. Okay, so I don't have to talk about different tests for it, right? If it fails 1-1 tests, it is a many one function. It's like coronavirus. There is no two tests whether you have it or you don't have it, right? Only one test. So if it is negative, you don't have it. If it is positive, you have it. Simple as that. Okay. So all the three tests, that is horizontal line test, uniqueness test, and calculus based test, will be equally applicable to this as well. Any questions here? Okay. Just a quick question, just to wrap up this topic. Again, the question is, let's say there is a function from A to B, where A has got, let's say, n elements and B has, let's say, r elements. Okay. How many many one functions are possible? How many many one functions are possible from A to B? Fast. Anybody can unmute himself or herself and respond to this. Go by the fact that many one is a complementary of 1-1.
So it will be r power n minus r factorial by n factorial.
Sorry? It is how much?
R power n minus r factorial by by n minus r factorial.
If r is less than n, then can I say it will be r to the power n only? Because when r is less than n, the number of 1-1 functions are zero. That means all the functions that are possible will be many one. Correct. So indirectly, what I'm doing, total function minus one function, right? One function was zero, right? Just refer to your previous notes, previous page. Okay. When r is greater than equal to n, it is r to the power n minus rp n. Is it fine? Any questions here? Okay. So no questions. So let me move on to another, division that the functions are categorized into. The other two complementary divisions are onto and into. Onto and into. Okay. They may sound like pintu and chintu. So it's onto and into. So onto functions are called surjective. Okay. Of course, what will be into? Non-surjective. So we don't have a separate word for it. Now, what's an onto function? A plain and simple definition that you will remember for the rest of your life. In any function, if the range is equal to its codomain, it's an onto function. Simple as that. That means every element of set B must have a image or must have at least one image. Okay. So definition wise, every element of set B. So let's say the function is from set A to set B. Every element of B has at least one pre-image. At least one pre-image is what makes a function onto function. This is a more easier way to remember. Range is equal to the codomain. Okay. And that's precisely why you were taught to find range in your class 11th. Right. So domain range exercise that you had done was done for this day so that you can easily make out whether the function is onto or not. Okay. So in order to figure out whether a function is onto, you have to do two steps. One, find the domain, but most of the time domain would be given to you. So even that step need not be done, but find the range and check whether the range and codomain, this is your codomain. Check whether the range is equal to the codomain. If it is a proper subset of the codomain, then it will be into function. If it is equal to it, that means an improper subset, then it would be a onto function. Is this clear? To give you an example of a onto function is simple x plus 2. Okay. If you find the range of x plus 2, it will take all real numbers. Okay. Is this fine? Okay. Now what is into? Same. Complementary of onto. Complementary of onto is into. So this is complement sets. So now understand here, a function cannot be both of them simultaneously. Just like a function cannot be one and many one simultaneously, they cannot be onto and into simultaneously because they're complementary of each other. But there can be a cross connection. It can be like one onto. It can be like one into. It can be like many one onto. It can be many one into. So like that categorization can be done. Okay. So what is an into function? To define it in a plain and simple word, at least one element of set B does not have a pre-image. So if you're able to show that there is at least one element in this set B, which is unmapped, that means that is alone. Okay. Then you are able to show that the function is a into function. let me give you a typical arrow diagram for it. Let's say A, B, C, D, and there is 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. So let's say A is mapping to 1, B is mapping to 1, C is mapping to 2, D is mapping to 3. Then you can see that 4 is unmapped. So if you're able to show the examiner that there is one element from your codomain set which is not participating in the mapping, which is not a part of your range, which is not able to become an image, then you're able to show that that function is into function or a non-surjective function. Is the idea clear? Is the idea clear, everybody? Okay. So here comes a question for you. In fact, it's a part of the theory which I would like to discuss. If let's say set A has n elements and set B has r elements, and there is a mapping from set A to set B. Okay. Tell me how many onto functions are possible from set A to set B. Think carefully and then answer. You may take case wise also. Okay, sorry, Shankin, I missed out on your question. Should there be a local extrema? Yes, I think you are talking about menu one, right, Shankin? Okay, so I'm getting different answers. Okay, let me take a scenario over here. I think there's not a single scenario here. I'll break this up into three scenarios: when R is greater than N, when R is equal to N, and when R is less than N. Okay, let me first take R greater than N. Let me take R greater than N. So R greater than N, let me just take a dummy case. So let's say we have three elements in set A, let's say A1, A2, A3, and five elements in set B. Okay. Now I have to make onto functions. Onto function means what? Onto function means none of the elements of set B must be left out. That means every element of set B must be your range, must be a part of your range. So let's say A1 goes and maps to B1. Okay. Now, even if I take worst case, A2 will map to somebody else, correct? A3 has to map to somebody else. This is the worst case, or this is the best case, you can say. But despite doing that, you will see that these two, you know, elements are left unmapped. These two elements are left unmapped. In other words, you can actually think this scenario as there are three different balls. There are three different balls. And there are five persons. Okay. How many ways can you distribute these three different balls such that each person gets at least one ball? Now you'll say it is not possible. Because even if you give, you know, 1-1 ball to B1, B2, B3, B4 and B5 will be without balls. Correct? Right? So you cannot ensure that each person gets at least one ball. So the answer from for this case will be zero. Answer for this case will be zero. Is that fine? Any questions here? Okay. Let's take the other scenario when R is equal to N. Oh, sorry. My mistake. R is equal to N. So R is equal to N. So let me make a scenario where R and N both are equal to each other. And let's say I take 5-5 in both of them. So let's say A to B. So this has, so there are 5 different balls and there are 5 different people. Correct? Of course, people are different only. So how many ways can you ensure that each person goes with at least one ball? So you cannot give 2 balls to one person, because if you do that, one person will go empty hand. So the only possibility is you have to give one each to them. Correct? So how many ways can this be done? It's very simple. So A1, let's say, has got, or A1 has got 5 opportunities. So A1 can map to any one of B1, B2, B3 till B5. A2 has also 4 opportunities. A3 will have 3. A4 will have 2. And A5 will have 1. So by fundamental principle of counting, the total number of onto functions you can make will be 5 factorial. So if you scale this up, your answer would be either be N factorial or R factorial, because both are same. Now, one thing that you would realize over here, that when the number of elements in set A and set B are equal, then the number of onto functions formed is the same as the number of 1-1 functions formed. Isn't it? Even for 1-1 function, the answer was R factorial or N factorial, whatever you want to call it. So when the number of elements in set A and set B are equal, you will always get a 1-1 onto functions from it. So 1-1 onto function number will always also be N factorial. Now this is what we used to call it as a bijective function. Correct? So this answers one more thing indirectly, that if you want to make a bijective function, then your total number of elements in set A and set B must be equal, right? So the number of bijective functions you can form from set A to set B having same number of elements, let's say R or N, is actually N factorial. So I'll write it down over here. It also gives you the number of bijections. Okay, so bijections cannot be formed till the number of elements in set A and set B are equal. Is this fine? Any questions here with R equal to N scenario? Okay. Now when N is greater than R, this scenario is slightly tricky. Okay, so I'm putting a question mark because I'm going to take this up in the next board. Okay, this situation is actually tricky when your N is greater than R. I can see answer coming from Ayush, but Ayush, that is not the answer actually. When N is greater than R, okay, then this scenario becomes a scenario of distribution of n distinct objects into r different groups without any blank group. Okay, if you recall, this is basically a concept which we had done in permutation combination chapter. Some of you were not there with us last year, but those who were with us, please remember this is a concept. Just go and check my notes. Okay, and you can find those notes on the on WhatsApp group also. So distribution of n distinct objects into r different groups when blank groups are not allowed, without any blank groups. Okay, so how do you carry out this scenario? Now, before I start, many people would think it in this way. They will think that if blank groups are not allowed, we can first give one object to all the groups, correct? One object to all the groups. So they'll select R objects from N objects in NCR way and distribute it into R groups in R factorial, correct? And the remaining N minus R objects, okay, they can be distributed in any way you want. So basically it is N minus R will have R choices. So many people think the answer is this, okay? But this is not correct. Why it is not correct? This is something that you will find it out for homework and let me know on my personal chat. This will lead to overcounting. Now, how does this result also come? Let me explain you. So many people think in this way. See, let's say these are my R different groups. I can call it as R boxes. So let's say box one, box two, till box R, fine. And let's say there are different balls, ball B1, okay. I'm making it of different shapes and sizes, ball B3, and so on till ball BN, okay. Now, if you want to distribute means give away these balls into these boxes without leaving any box empty, then how does one do this? So those people who think this is the answer, they say, let me choose first one ball for each box. So they will choose R balls from N. Okay. And of course, when you have R balls and R boxes, you can distribute it in R factorial ways. Okay. So let's say now R of them is gone. So how many are left? So if R is gone, you are left with N minus R. Okay. You are left with N minus R, right? Left with N minus R balls. Now each ball here has got R choices. Correct? Each ball here has got R choice. Okay, so this is basically ulta. R to the power N minus R. Yeah. So each ball has got R choices. So R into R into R up till N minus R times, you will end up getting R to the power N minus R. Okay. Sorry, I interchanged the position. But this answer is not correct. And you have to find it out why it is not correct. Okay. Hint is it will lead to overcounting. Fine. So please let me know over the WhatsApp group why this answer is not going to give you the right answer. Okay. So what do we do in that case? How do we accomplish this? So we have to apply something which we call as principle of inclusion and exclusion. Now I want to warn people here that you are heading towards a slightly difficult concept. So pay attention. If possible, put away your pens. Just listen to what I have to say. Okay. So how to do this? This is not a correct way to do it. So I'm just putting a cross mark over here. This is not a right formula. Okay. So how to do this? So everybody, please listen to me. Let me put a bifurcation. Okay. So let me again make a scenario that we have R different boxes. ... Box one, box two, till box R. Okay, and there are n different balls, okay, of different shapes and sizes. Okay. So let's say B1, B2, da 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 till BN. Okay. Now, my first question to all of you is, if there is no restriction, that means you can put any number of balls in any box you want. So boxes can be empty also. So if there is no restriction, if there is no restriction, in how many ways can you place these balls into these boxes?
R power n.
R to the power n. Very good. Because every ball will have R options. So ball 1 can go in any one of the R boxes. Ball 2 can also go in any one of the R boxes. Ball 3 also can go in any of the R boxes till ball number n. So R into R into R into R into R into R, n number of times, so R to the power n. Let me call this figure as NU. Okay. That is the number of elements in the universal set. That means this is the distribution without any restriction. Now, pay attention, everybody. Let's say even is the event when box number 1 is empty. Even is the event when box number 1 is empty. Now try to understand here, I am not saying that other boxes may not be empty or other boxes will not be empty. I am just saying box number 1 is empty. Others may or may not be empty. That I don't care. But I'm what I'm saying here, my box number 1 has to be empty. Okay. So if there's no ball allowed in box number 1, then how many ways can you perform this distribution?
R to the power n minus 1.
R minus 1 to the power n.
R minus 1 to the power n, right? Because every ball will have R minus 1 choices, right? Because ball 1 cannot enter box 1. So ball 1 will have R minus 1 choices. Correct? Even ball 2 will have R minus 1 choices. Even ball 3 will have R minus 1 choices. So all these balls will have R minus 1 choices. So this will be your event. Okay. So if I continue making a list till ER being the event that box R is empty, box number R is empty, will you all agree that that will also be R minus 1 to the power n? So I'm just putting dot, dot, dot. Okay. I'm not writing anything. Is it fine? Any questions here? Now, if you're wondering why am I doing this, I'll connect the dots little later on. So just understand the scenario as of now. Now, let's say E1 intersection E2 is an event when box number 1 and box number 2 are empty. Correct? Tell me in how many ways can I now perform my distribution when I don't want any ball to enter in 1 and 2. Now, it doesn't mean others cannot be empty. Others may or may not be empty. But even in into, pakka pakka will be empty. So, how many ways can I perform this?
R minus 2 to the power n.
Excellent. You guys are awesome. So, if I just make a generic event saying that E1 intersection, EI intersection EJ is an event where box I and box J are empty, you would all admit to the fact that the number of ways in which I can perform this event is R minus 2 to the power n. Okay. And similarly, I'm not writing any more here. Number of ways in which you are ensuring ith box, jth box and kth box are empty will be R minus 3 to the power n, right? And so on. And so on. Correct. Now, let me now connect the dot over here. What am I trying to find here? I'm trying to find out the number of ways in which I don't allow my box 1 to be empty and my box 2 to be empty and box 3 to be empty and so on till my box number R to be empty. So this is what I'm looking for. I'm looking for the number of elements in even complement, intersection E2 complement, intersection E3 complement, all the way till ER complement. right? See, because my situation is, I don't want an empty box without a blank group. Blank group means empty box, right? So I don't want box one to be empty, and I don't want box two to be empty, and I don't want box three to be empty, till I don't want box R to be empty, correct? Now, there is a famous law called De Morgan's law. De Morgan's law says that, just recall De Morgan's law. What is De Morgan's law? What is De Morgan's law? N of A complement intersection B complement is, it is basically what? N of A union B whole complement, right? N of A union B whole complement is what? N universal set minus N A union B, right? This is De Morgan's law, correct? So I'm applying the same over here, and I'm saying it is N universal set minus N of even union E2 union E3 till union ER. Correct? Now again, recall your cardinal number properties which you had done in class 11th. I hope you all remember the property N of A union B union C is what? NA plus NB plus NC. Let me write it as N summation NA minus NA intersection B and B intersection C and C intersection A. Let me write it as NA intersection B. So I'm just using short form notation. Okay. I don't want to write that down. So you can extend this particular cardinal property. By the way, this itself is principle of inclusion and exclusion. This itself is principle of inclusion and exclusion. Okay, why it is called principle of inclusion and exclusion? Because you include, then you subtract. Subtract means exclude. Then again you include, then again there would be a subtract if at all there are more sets, right? So you include one at a time, remove two at a time, then include three at a time, then remove four at a time, like that. Okay, so according to principle of inclusion and exclusion, you can write this as summation of N EY. E1 or EI you can write minus summation N E1 intersection E2 plus summation N E1 intersection E2 intersection E3. Let me move slightly to the right. And this will go on and on till your number of sets are there. Okay, so I'm not writing, doesn't mean infinity, it will go up till it can go. Okay, that's what I'm trying to say. Okay. Now time to fill in this gap. So now we are at the last step. This was R to the power N. You only told me this is R to the power N. Here, R to the power N. Okay. So I'm placing it over here. Now, NE1 was R minus 1 to the power N. So if you add all of them, remember there are R of these. So it will become R times R minus 1 to the power N. Correct? Now, just to maintain a pattern, I'll write RC1. RC1 is also R only. No problem. Right? Minus. E1 intersection E2, if you see, you only told it will be R minus 2 to the power N. And how many such pairs will be possible? How many pairs you can make from R?
RC2.
So RC2, R minus 2 to the power N. So this trend will continue, my dear. And this will become your answer. So this is the formula of number of onto functions from set A to set B, where set A has got N elements and set B has got R elements. Right? So the expression is slightly complicated, and many a times I have seen the students forget this formula, but I'll tell you a method by which you can do away with this formula also. So this formula is just optional. It is for those people who like remembering formula. When I was preparing for my JEE, I never remembered this formula, but still I could solve all problems. I'll tell you how. I just use my basic understanding of PNC. So please note this down as of all. As of now, please note this down. Remember, if possible. If possible. Okay. I'll give you some demonstrations on this. I'll give you some illustrations on this. Don't worry. Do you want me to move the screen left, right? It is actually not important for you to copy this. Just understand what is the core principle by which this formula was derived. Okay. So let me give you an example that will make things more clear. Now, let us say you want to make number of onto functions from set A to set B, where set A has got 5 elements and set B has got 3 elements. Okay. In other words, you can think as if there are 5 balls and there are only 3 takers for it. So let's say A1, A2, A3, A4, A5 are 5 balls, and B1, B2, B3 are 3 people who wants to take these balls, such that each person gets at least 1 ball. Okay. Now, if I use the formula, what is the number of onto functions? Number of onto functions from the formula is r to the power n minus rc1 r minus 1 to the power n minus rc2 r minus 2 to the power n plus rc3 r minus 3 to the power n da 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 da. Correct. Now it will automatically start becoming 0 at one point of time, so I don't have to bother about it. So r here is this guy, n here is this guy. Correct. So the answer would be 3 to the power 5 minus rc1 is what? Rc1 is 3c1. This will be r minus 1, which is 2 to the power 5. Then you will have 3c2. R minus 2 will be 1 to the power 5. And I think after this term, it will become a 0. So you stop over here. So your answer would be 243 minus, this will be 3 into 32, which is 96. Minus 3, which is 93. So 243 minus 93, that means 150 ways. Okay. Now, this is by use of formula. Okay. Now, I'll use my common sense to solve this without using formula. Okay. Now, assume that there are 3 boxes and there are 5 balls, and you have to place these 5 balls in these 3 boxes such that no box is empty. Okay, so there are 5 balls waiting outside, B1, B2, B3, B4, B5. B4, B5. Okay, so how will you distribute it? So one distribution could be 2, 2, 1. Right? If you're distributing 2 balls to the first box, you can choose 2 from 5 in 5C2. Correct? Yes or no? If you're giving 2 balls to the second box, you can choose the remaining from the remaining 3 in 3C2 ways. Okay? And the leftover ball will go in the third box. So that is 1C1. You need not write it also. Now, there could be a shuffling of the balls also. There could be shuffling over here. You can have 1, 2, 2 also. 2, 1, 2 also, like that. So how many shuffling can happen? You can shuffle it is in as many ways as you can make a 3-digit number from 221. How many 3-digit number you can make from 221? 3 factorial by 2 factorial, right? Okay. So in this case, your answer will come out to be 10 into 3. Into 3, which is 90. Okay. Now this is one of the case. Second case is 3, 1, 1. That is also a case. Okay. So here also you are ensuring that every box gets a ball, or every person gets a ball. So in this case, your distribution will be 5C3, then 2C1, and of course 1C1. And how many ways can you shuffle it? You can make it as 1-3-1 or 1-1-3. So again, 3 ways, which you can actually write it as 3 factorial by 2 factorial again. So your answer will be 10 into 2 into 3, which is 60. So cases means you have to add these two and you end up getting the same answer 150 ways. So here by use of formula, here by use without use of formula, I got the same result. Okay. So go with this method, you will never forget your stuff. You'll never forget your basic understanding. Another way to look at it is, many people say, sir, can we apply division into groups formula? Division into groups. In this case, you are doing division into groups with the order of the group being important. Okay, so let me recall this also. So all your PNCs are getting tested over here. See, if you divide 5 into 3 groups of 2 to 1, okay, how many ways can you do it? You will say 5 factorial by 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 1 factorial. But since these two groups contain same number of items, you have to further divide by 2 factorial. And since order is important, you have to multiply with 3 factorial. Now, don't ask me how, because this is already explained in the chapter PNC. If you want, you can go today, check out that video and watch that video n number of times again. Okay. So this will give you, if I'm not wrong, 120 by 8 into 6. 120 by 8 is 15. 15 into 6 is 90. Okay. So this is what we had got here also, 90. Okay. Another is we distribute it as 5, object as 3, 1, 1. So same formula here also, 5 factorial by 3 factorial, 1 factorial, 1 factorial. And since these two are having same number of items, you have to divide by 2 factorial. And since order is important, into 3 factorial. So 3 factorial, 3 factorial gone. So 120 by 2 is 60. So 90 plus 60, again you end up getting 150. It doesn't matter which way you take up, end result is the same. Any question here, anybody? Okay, Tripan, we'll discuss it. Okay, so just give me this argument. You just type this out and send it to me on my WhatsApp. Okay. Is this fine, everybody? So now you know how to find out the number of onto functions also. Okay, let's take a question on onto function. Very easy one. I'll start with a very easy one. Okay, question is, if this function is a surjection, find the set A over here.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
Can you please go to the previous slide?
Oh yeah, sure.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Done?
One second.
Shomik, are you sure one is inclusive? Okay, so basically this is an exercise which you would have done endless number of time in class 11th, finding the range of a function whose domain is an infinite interval. So here the approach used to be, remember, used to make y is equal to the function, and then used to make x the subject of the formula and apply the constraints of the domain on it. So when you make x the subject of the formula, let's write it like this. So x square y plus y is equal to x square. So you can write x square 1 minus y is equal to y. So x square is equal to y by 1 minus y. Okay. Now, domain of this function is all real numbers. So when x is all real numbers, we already know that x square has to be positive, which means y by 1 minus y should be positive. Okay, you can go for a wavy curve for this case. So this will be 0, this will be 1. And now please be very careful, it will be minus plus minus. Okay, because here it is 1 minus y, not y minus 1. Okay, so greater than equal to 0 is this inside zone. So your y should lie between 0 to 1, 0 inclusive, but 1 cannot be included. Okay, so this is primarily the range of the function, and the range should be equal to, for onto function, range should be equal to the codomain. Codomain is your A in this case. So you can say that your set A can be 0 to 1, 1 exclusive. Okay. Yes, why not? We can write x square as x square plus 1 minus 1. Why not? It won't affect the answer, Aditya. All right? Okay. All right. Now, into, I don't have to spend much time with you. Okay, I'll just talk about into also. Into is basically complementary of onto. So what I'll do here is, let's do a quick exercise on, you know, finding the number of into functions. Finding the number of into functions. Okay. Now I would say it is very easy, sir, because now I know number of onto functions. So I can easily find out the number of into by subtracting the total number of functions minus the number of onto functions. Remember, number of onto function when r was greater than n. When r was greater than n, how many onto functions used to be there? 0, right? When the number of people are more than the number of balls, okay, r is the number of people, n is the number of balls, you cannot provide every person with at least one ball. Okay. When r is equal to n, your answer would be r to the power n minus n factorial or r factorial, whatever you want to call it. And when r is less than n, it is basically, and now try to recall the formula. The formula was r to the power n, rc1, r minus 1 to the power n, minus rc2, r minus 2 to the power n. Right. So if you subtract this from r to the power n, you'll realize that you'll only see rc1, r minus 1 to the power n, minus rc2, r minus 2 to the power n, and so on. Okay. So one of them, if you remember, you'll be able to find the other one also easily. Is this okay? Okay. So before we move on to bijections, there's one question that I would like you all to attempt. Okay, so read this question carefully. There's a function from R to R defined as a piecewise function, x mod x minus 4 when x is rational, and x mod x minus root 3 when x is irrational. Identify the type of function. That means you have to comment whether it is 1-1 onto, 1-1 into, or many-1 onto, many-1 into. So four categories. So which of the four categories does it fall into? So identify the function as 1-1 onto or 1-1 into or many-1 onto or many-1 into. Which of the four categories is the function falling into? Think carefully and then answer. You can type your response on your chat box.
Sir.
To the previous slide, Aditya. You want me to go to the previous slide? Okay. Oh, is it? I think it's going to rain soon at my place as well. Done? Taking a snapshot?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Sure. Okay, so Ayush has given his response. What about others? Okay, Skanda, noted down your answer. Now here, don't try to solve this question by graphing it, because you know you can't make graphs for such conditions where you have some Dirichlet type functions involved. Dirichlet function is where your domain is rational, irrational type of situation. So it's very difficult to plot such graphs. Okay. So graphing will not help you. Now, how do I solve this question? So let us try to, you know, go the reverse. Let's have a reverse psychology over here. Let's try to prove that it is, you know, not a 1-1 function. Okay. Can it ever have, see, this function, we all know x mod x graph. X mod x graph is like this. So it's a downward parabola down and upward parabola up. Okay. Now, in itself, this function, of course, minus 4 will just shift this down. So it doesn't change its 1-1 nature. So in itself, this function is 1-1. Correct? So no matter whatever, you know, number you put, it is going to give you different values for different inputs. Correct? So this is a continuous graph, but even if you take any, you know, different rational numbers, it is going to give you different answers. In the same way, this guy also is 1-1 in itself. It is 1-1 in itself. Okay. So overall, it gives a feeling that, oh, it has to be a 1-1 function. But wait, can I find such a value for which both of them gives me the same input? Same output. So let's say if I put a 2 here, let's say 2 mod 2 minus 4, and let's say if I put 4th root of 3. Okay, so all of you please try to figure out what are these outputs. So f of 2 will give you, 2 being a rational number, will follow the first definition. So 2 mod 2 minus 4, that will give you a 0. And 4th root of 3 is an irrational number, so it will follow the second definition. So it will give me 3 to the power 1/4 into 3 to the power 1/4 minus 3 to the power half. That will also give you a 0. What do you realize over here? So you realize that there are two inputs which will give you the same output 0. In this case, one example is sufficient for us to show it is a many one. So these two options are ruled out. Now, whether it's many one onto or many one into, how do we figure this out? So now I have to take some real number which cannot be obtained from, any x. What will it be? If I'm unsuccessful in doing that, that means it is a onto. So can you try out thinking of an example where the output is such which is a real number but doesn't come from any input? Try minus root 3. Let's say the output is, let's say there is some input for which I get the answer is minus root 3. Okay, let's see what is this input. Now, if you follow the first definition, you end up getting x mod x minus 4 as minus root 3. That means x mod x is equal to 4 minus root 3. Okay. Now, this is either minus x square or x square. I don't know any real number or any rational number whose square gives you an irrational number. So there is no such x belonging to rational number for which the square of it or negative of the square of it gives you 4 minus root 3. Right? So obviously minus root 3 cannot be obtained from any x coming from the first definition. So what is left? It should come from any x coming from the second definition. So let's say if I do this, you would realize that x becomes 0 here, which is actually a rational number, but this definition was supposed to be for not rational. See, it was crossed over here, right? Right? So ultimately, you cannot put 0 into your second function. So you cannot get minus root 3. So what do I mean? I mean that this real number cannot come from any x, neither from rational number nor from irrational number. So this answer is, it is a into function. Into function, that means your function is 1-1 and into. Many 1 and into. Is this clear? Anybody has any doubt in this, any concerns in this, please ask. in two parts. See, Shashank, what I'm trying to say here is, recall the definition of onto and into. When is a function onto? When the entire codomain, this is your codomain, right? Codomain is all real numbers, right? When your entire codomain is your range also. So if I'm able to show that there exists at least one real number which is not mapped or which cannot be obtained from any X or which doesn't have any pre-image, then it becomes into. So my effort is towards that direction. So what I do is I choose a number minus root 3, right? And I want to see whether minus root 3 can come from any rational number or any irrational number. Now, no rational number will give you x mod x is equal to 4 minus root 3 because this is clearly irrational. So x mod x will always be rational if x is rational. So a rational number can never give you. So this is ruled out. Now, can an irrational number give me x mod x minus root 3 as minus root 3? So when I tried that, when I tried equating, I got x as 0, but x is not irrational, x is rational. So here it should have been irrational. Here it should have been irrational, right? So even 0 is not permitted, correct? So minus root 3 cannot be obtained from any x. And hence this function will not be a onto function, so it will be an into function. Now is it clear? Okay. So now you all take a break. Everybody, please take a break. Okay. Take a break. We'll resume at 6:23 p.m. Fine. Good enough time. Eat something. Have water. Come back in 15 minutes. Bijective function. So bijective functions, we have already discussed what's a bijective function. So bijective functions are ones which are both injective as well as surjective. So injective plus surjective makes it bijective. Okay. Now functions which are invertible have to be bijective. Why? So that's the number one question. Why functions which are invertible have to be bijective? Why a function has to be 1-1 necessarily and onto necessarily for it to be an invertible function? Now it is basically coming from the very basic definition of a function and its inverse. So when f acts on a to b, okay, its inverse acts from b to a, right? Correct? So this is something which is known to us from the very basic definition of a function and its inverse. So let's say my function is not 1-1. My function is not 1-1. Then see what will happen. Let me take a dummy example of a function which is not a 1-1 function. Okay. So let's say we have a, b, c, and let's say we have 1, 2, and the mapping is like this. So a is mapping to 1, b and c both are mapping to 2, 2. Okay. Now for such a function, if you start making its inverse arrow diagram, so inverse will operate from b to a. Okay. So let me write f inverse on top, and it will work on 1 and 2 to give you a, b, c. So 1 will give you a. Remember, 1 came from A. So when you put A into the function, it gave you 1, right? So when you put A into the function, it gave you 1. So putting 1 in the inverse should give you A back. So this is how the mapping happens. Correct? But putting B and C both gave you 2. So putting 2 will be giving you both B and C. Now this is violating the very basic definition of a function. The very basic definition of a function is every pre-image must have a unique image. So this is not a function at all. For it about it being an inverse function, it is not even worth calling a function. Okay. So your function f cannot be a 1-1 function. Cannot be a many-1 function. right? So it has to be 1-1. So it has to be injective. Okay. Now let me show you what will happen if it is not onto. If it is not onto, see what problem will you face. So again, let me give you an example of a function which is not a onto function. So let's say a, b, c, and you have 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so let's say it is 1, 1, but it is not onto. You can see 4 is left out. That's why it is not onto. Okay. So when you plot its inverse, arrow diagram for its inverse, so it goes from B to A. Okay. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and this will be A, B, C. So putting A gave you 1. So putting 1 in its inverse will give you A. Putting B gave you 2. So putting 2 in the inverse will give you B. Putting C gave you 3. So putting 3 in the inverse will give you C. But what about this? This is again unmapped, which is again violating the basic definition of a function. So it is not a function, forget it, to be an inverse of a function. So it is not a function itself. That's why function has to be onto or has to be surjective in order to be invertible. So these two criteria are important. So in any function where your function is a 1-1 and onto, then only you can find the inverse for it. Else you will not be able to find the inverse for such functions. Is this fine? Any questions here? Okay. Now the next thing that comes in your mind, how do we find the inverse of a function? That is a very important exercise that is going to come for you in your school as well. Okay. So how to find the inverse, finding the inverse of a function. Okay. Now all of you, please pay attention to this. This is slightly tricky. Now you're finding y is equal to this. And what are you given? You have been given a function which is a 1-1 and an onto function, and it is defined like this. Okay, so assuming that it's a bijection, how do you find out the inverse of the function? Now, do you all agree that saying this is equivalent to saying x is equal to fy? X is equal to f of y. Correct? Both are same thing, mind you. Both are same things. Right? So now I have to find this. Correct? So it's just simple. What is there in this? Just swap the position of x and y and you're done. Of course, that is obviously correct. So in your any given function, just swap the position of x and y, right? And make y the subject of the formula. And you are done. Okay, so these two steps you have to do. One is this step and second is this step. Because you normally your teacher will ask you to represent it as y is equal to something, right? So this is what you have to finally represent. So the moment you swap it, you get this equation. However, that is also the answer, but that will look very weird. So you have to write y in terms of x. I'll give you an example. Acha, by the way, when you write the inverse, please mention its domain and range. If you don't know the domain, but at least mention that its domain will be the range of the original function. Okay. So let's say I define a function. Let me take an example. I define a function like 3x minus 5. Right? We all know that it is a bijection. Because it will pass the horizontal line test and its range is equal to its codomain. Codomain is all real numbers, correct? So it is 1-1 and onto both. Okay. So how do you find the inverse of the function? So first write this as y equal to this and then replace your, or you can say swap your y with x. You can say swap y and x. The moment you do that, basically this should be your answer. This is your answer. Okay. But normally your teachers will say they want to see y is equal to something. They want it. You want the answer. They want the answer to see like look like this. Okay. So what you can do is you can write this second step as 3y is equal to x plus 5. So y is equal to x plus 5 by 3. Okay. So this becomes the inverse of your given function. So this is f inverse x. Okay. So if this is your f of x, if this is your f of x, then this is your f inverse x. Is that clear? Any questions here? Okay. Now, some teachers will tell you to do the opposite way. First, they will say make x the subject of the formula. So there's another way. This is method number one. Method number two is they'll say make x the subject of the formula. So from here, we can say x is equal to y plus 5 by 3. Okay. And then they will say swap the position of x and y. Okay, so ultimately the end result will be the same. So it is up to you. So whether you want to first make x the subject of the formula, sorry, this is the first step, and then swap the position of x and y, or you want to do the other way around, first swap the position of x and y and then make y the subject of the formula. It's your call. Is this fine? Any questions regarding this? Now, how do one verify that they are inverses of each other? So I did something, but I did not verify whether they are inverses of each other. It is very easy to verify. If you put f inverse, the entire function, if you put in the given function, so f inverse you put in the given function f of x, you would realize you will get x. Okay. Now, one important thing I would like to add over here, this x here comes from set B. See, this function was defined from A to B, right? So your inverse would be defined from, remember your inverse would be defined from set B to set A. Now we have not done composite function officially, but soon we'll do it. You would realize that the input that you can feed to this function inside should be the in the domain of your F inverse function. So this X will come from your set B. Okay. Similarly, f inverse f of x will also give you x, but this time this x will come from domain of f. Correct? And domain of f will be your a. This is something very important. So many books will write this in this way. They will say f of f inverse is ib, and this they will write it as f inverse of will be ia. They just mean to say that it is an identity function. I stands for identity function. What is identity function? Something which returns you the same input as output. Remember identity relation you have done, correct? So only a comma a kind of elements are there. Okay, so if you put some, let's say 5, it will return 5 to you. So 5 comma 5 will be there in this particular kind of, this is a relation, by the way. All functions are relations at the end of the day. Okay. But we give it a name IB because your X that you get will come from the set B. And this is called IA because this X that you will get will come from set A. Is the idea clear about how to find inverse and how to check whether one is the inverse of the other? So as of now, I have not done the test. Let me do this test. So let me do the first activity first. So I'm putting x plus 5 by 3 in place of 3x minus 5, right? Yeah, 3x minus 5. You yourself would see that 3 gets cancelled. 5 will get cancelled and you'll end up getting an x. So this is satisfying this particular characteristic. So this is correct. Okay. Similarly, in the expression of the inverse, if you put, so this is the expression of the inverse, if you put the original function, so let's say 3x minus 5, you're putting in place of x and do this operation, again you realize 5 gone and then 3-3 will be gone and you'll be ending up getting an X. So this is satisfying the other one. So this is also correct. Okay. So what we have found out is a correct result. So both these functions are inverses of each other. Okay. So if you know its domain and range, the right way to complete your answer is your F inverse is this for all X belonging to the domain of the function. Domain of the function will be the range here. So you can say for all R. Okay, or X belonging to all real numbers. Okay, for all you can remove and just write a comma also. No worries. Any question here on finding the domain? On finding the inverse.
So could you go down?
So this is the verification. Now in your exams, do you have to verify? No, not for at least showing the examiner, but you can do it for yourself if you want to. If you're not very confident about your approach, you can. So any of the two verifications will work because both will be inverses of each other. Should I go to the next page now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So let us look into the properties of inverse. Properties of inverse of a function. This is very important, so keep this in mind. The first property is inverse of a function is unique and it itself is a bijection. Now this is very obvious because if it is not a bijection, then F is the inverse of F inverse, isn't it? So F and F inverse both are inverses of each other. So since F is the inverse of F inverse, that means F inverse is invertible. If F inverse is invertible, it means it has to be a bijection. Okay. This point is very important. Unique. Unique means you cannot have two inverses for the same function. Okay. So there can only be one answer for the inverse. This is important. I'm telling you, you don't write two answers for inverse of a function. However, the situation will arise where you will feel that there are two outcomes coming. So which one of them will be your answer? That is something that you have to decide there. I will do some problems of that type also with you. Okay. So inverse of a function is unique and itself is a bijection. Okay. Second thing is, if there's a composition of two functions, let's say f and g, okay, then inverse of it follows the law of reversal. This is called the law of reversal. So f o g, I think I have not done a composition of functions with you yet. Sir, can two functions have the same inverse? For two functions have the same inverse, that means the inverse should give you two opposite inverse. So how it can happen? See, let's say f and g gives you the same inverse. Okay, let's say h, then opposite should also be true, no? So inverse of h should be f also, inverse of h should be g. So again, the uniqueness criteria is violated, right? So I think the answer, in fact, what I think, I'm sure the answer there is no. Okay. Now, what is law of reversal? I'll just take a simple example here, just to illustrate that how it works. Let us say I have two functions, 2x plus 3 and g of x, which is e to the power x. So let's say these are the two functions, f of x, which is 2x plus 3, And there's another function g of x, which is e to the power x. Okay. Now, again, I'm repeating this. I have not done officially the inverse of a function with you. Composition of a function with you. But as of now, this is a very simple task. If you want to find the composite function f of g, all you need to do is put this in place of x. So your answer will be 2e to the power x plus 3. Okay. Correct. Now, find the inverse of this. Find the inverse of this function. So which approach you want to follow? Do you want to swap the position of x and y and then make y the subject of the formula? Or do you want to make x the subject of the formula first and then swap x and y? The call is yours. Okay. So let me do one thing. Let me swap the position of x and y over here. Okay. And then let me make y the subject of the formula. So it will be x minus 3 by 2 ln of that. Okay. So this function has its inverse. So let me write it like this. F of g inverse will be ln of x minus 3 by 2. Fine. Now I will prove in front of you that g inverse or f inverse will be the same thing. It's just a verification I'm doing. It's not a proof. It's a verification I'm doing. Okay. Just to make you clear about it. So when I do this, f inverse, we all know is what? Can you just figure out f inverse from here? Anybody can speak it out? I think it's a mental game. You don't have to pick up a pen for this. What do you think will be the inverse of this?
X minus 3 by 2.
Absolutely. What will be the g inverse? Now, this is something which is very famous. We all know it's ln of x, correct? Now, if you do g inverse or f inverse, that means if you feed this function in place of x over here, you will see that you end up getting what we had got on the left side. So these two are same. Okay. So this is the law of reversal, and it can be applied to any number of functions. So let's say if you have f of g of h of x and you're inverting it, it will follow the law of reversal. So it'll be h inverse o g inverse o f inverse. Is this fine? Now for a homework, please give me a generic proof for this. Why it works. Okay, why this law of reversal is followed. Any questions here up till property number 2? Okay, third property is something which is very important. The graph of the function and its inverse are mirror images of each other about the line y equal to x. Right? Now, why is it so? If you look at these two functions, this is of course this, and this is actually x equal to f of y. So you can see that you have actually swapped the position of x and y to obtain this. Okay. So this is obtained by swapping y with x. Okay. When you're swapping y with x. Okay. So think as if you are swapping x to y and y to x. It can only happen if you are keeping a mirror which is at 45 degrees like this. Okay, of course, mirrored at both the sides. So only way your y can become x and x can become y is when there's a mirror like this place, isn't it? So we say that the images, function f of x and f inverse x are mirror images about y equal to x line. Okay, you can try it out in the previous example. I had given y is equal to 3x minus 5. And its inverse was y is equal to x plus 5 by 3, right? I will just quickly draw their graphs on GeoGebra and just show you. Where is my GeoGebra? Okay, So y is equal to 3x plus 5, sorry, 3x minus 5. And y is equal to x plus 5 by 3. X plus 5 by 3. Okay. Now I'll also draw y equal to x for your reference. Now see, this is y is equal to x. This is y is equal to x plus 5 by 3. And this is y is equal to 3x plus 5, 3x minus 5. Okay. They're exactly mirror images about this line as a mirror. So if you treat this line as a mirror, of course, mirrored on both the sides, okay, you would realize that one is the reflection of the other. Okay. Why it happens is for the simple reason. If you take a point over here, let's say I take this point. Let me take an integral point. Yeah. Let's say I take 1, minus 2. And if you want to switch the position of 1 and minus 2, that means if you want to make it minus 2, 1, that means you want to come over here. Okay. It can only happen when you are treating the mirror image of this point about y equal to x line. So this will be equidistant from this mirror. Okay. So when you bring about this transformation, you'll have to use y equal to x as a mirror for this transformation. Isn't it? This is how the functions work, right? So A, if you feed, it'll give you B. In inverse, if you feed B, it'll give you A, right? Okay. So when you're bringing about such transformations, you'll have to reflect it about y equal to x line. Any questions here? Now, a very important outcome from this result is, and I mean, it's actually a debatable outcome, but I've seen many books, including Cengage and all, they write such things. So outcome of it is, or you can say a derived result of this is, if you are solving an equation where a function has been equated to its inverse, okay, then many books says that the solution of this is same as, the solution of this is same as equating the function to x. In other words, f inverse and f of x meet at the same positions where y equal to x meets the function. Now, it is because many people, they take a very generic view out of it. Let's say this is my function. Okay. So this is the inverse of the function. Right. And you know that these two are mirror images about, y equal to x line. So let me make it in blue, y equal to x line. Correct. Okay. So just consider it to be y equal to x only. Okay. Now the thing that if you want to know where does a function and its inverse meet, it is as good as knowing where does the function and y equal to x meet. This is what they're trying to claim. Right. But I feel that this property is not completely true. It may work for many cases, but it will not work for all the cases. So there are a few cases that I have figured out where it will not work. For example, let us say if you want to solve, let's say your function is minus x cube. Okay. So what is the inverse of this function? Anybody can tell me the inverse of this function? Minus x cube. Class. Yes, anybody? Minus cube root of x. Correct. Okay. Now let us try to solve them. Let's try to equate them. Achha, by the way, cube root of minus, this will come as a minus x to the power 1/3. Correct. Minus. Gone. Correct. Isn't it? So that'll give you x to the power 9 is equal to x. Okay. So one solution could be x equal to 0. Another solution could be 1 and minus 1. Okay. So these are the three solutions coming from it. Right. So equating these two will give you three solutions. But if you equate your f of x to x only, you would realize that in this case the only solution coming is zero. That means I don't obtain these two solutions. Okay, so people or books who say that solving this is as good as solving this because they both meet on y equal to x line, that is not a right way to find out the number of solutions. I'll show you from the graph also. See, I'll hide this. I'll first draw the graph of y is equal to minus x cube. Okay. And I'll draw the graph of y is equal to minus x whole to the power 1/3. Okay. What do you see? Of course, there are mirror images about y equal to x. But the points where your function, that is your green line and your orange line, if I'm not colorblind, they're meeting are these three. -1, 0, and 1, correct? And your function is meeting y equal to x only at this point. So only 0 is coming out from it. So other two solutions are missing. Yes or no? Other two solutions are missing in this case. Fine. So please do not go by this kind of logic that solving this is as good as solving this. The answer, the conclusion is may not be true for all cases. May not be true for all cases. And some good authors have also made this mistake. Okay. Now, we'll talk about how to find inverse of a piecewise function. How to find inverse of a piecewise function. Piecewise defined function. This is very important, especially for JE. Especially for JE, this is very, very important concept. Let me take an example for finding the inverse of a piecewise function. Let me see if I have a question on that. Okay, let's say this example. Okay, for a single function, the process was very easy, right? You swapped the position of x and y and then made y the subject of the formula. Or you made x the subject of the formula and then swapped the position of x and y. So how will I find the inverse in cases where your function is defined in a piecewise manner? Now, since this is the first question, I'll give you one more follow-up question. Let me do it for you. Okay. See, the approach is not very different. We'll again start with the fact that y is equal to this. Okay. Okay. Then step number one is you swap the position of x and y. So step number one, you swap y and x. Okay. So when you swap y and x, x will come over here and here y will come over here inside. So y when y is less than 1 and y square when y is between 1 and 4 and 8 root y when y is greater than 4. Correct? No doubt about step number one. Okay. Now step number two is make y the subject of the formula. So let me break it into pieces. So first you're saying x is equal to y and y less than 1. Now when you make y the subject of the formula, okay, it becomes y is equal to x and this y is x itself, so it will become x less than 1. Okay, so the first part of the conversion will give you the inverse as x when x is less than 1. So there will be no change. And it is obvious. Why will not be any change in the inverse? Because that itself is y equal to x line. So a line, when it is itself y is equal to x, what will be the reflection of it about y equal to x? The very same line. What is the reflection of the mirror on the mirror? The mirror itself, isn't it? Okay. Now, next part. Next part. Next part is where you are making y is equal to root plus minus root x. Now, which one will you take? Will you take plus root x or minus root x? Because they cannot be two answers. Your inverse is unique. Which one will you take? Class, this is a question for you.
Plus root x.
Why?
Because y lies from 1 to 4.
Correct. So in this case, your negative has to be dropped off. Okay, of course, we don't write positive. We just write root x. Okay. Now, here also you have to make the same replacement. That is, your root x will lie between 1 to 4. A sober way to write it is x lying between 1 to 16. Okay. So your function will behave as root x when your x lies between 1 to 16. Correct. Now, coming to the last part. Last part, when you say x is equal to 8 root y, y will be equal to, if I'm not mistaken, x square by 64. Correct? And x square by 64 will be greater than 4. Yes or no? Yes or no? So if x square is greater than 64, that means x square is greater than 256. That means x should be greater than 16. Yes or no? Right? Now, if you combine these three pieces and make a one function out of it, your final answer would be f inverse x is x when x lies from minus infinity to 1. It will behave as root x when x lies between 1 to 16, and will behave as x square by 64 when x is greater than 16. Because this is going to be your answer. Is the approach clear? Any questions regarding this? Is the approach clear? Any questions here? Now, you may try to make the graph out of it. See, I'll plot the graph for both of them, and I'll show you how this function actually works. Okay, so all of you, please help me to copy this on GeoGebra. So I'll be plotting it now for you. So your y is equal to, if x is less than 1, it follows x, right? Okay. If x is between 1 to 4, it follows. Can somebody tell me what is that?
1 to 16.
1 to 16, so root x.
No. Original function. Original function.
Y square.
Original function is what? Original function is x square, no? Yeah, this one I'm typing. Yeah. So x square. X square. Okay. And when it is, greater than 4, it is following 8 root x. So x is, what is wrong with this? X is greater than 4, it is following 8 root x. Okay. So this is your graph. Correct. So of course it is invertible because it's a 1-1 function. Any horizontal line you'll draw, it'll make it cut at one point, and it is onto also. Okay. Now, if I want to write down the inverse of this function, what was the inverse that we had got? Can somebody dictate me? If x is less than 1, it follows x. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And what is the next one?
Root x.
When it is less than equal to?
Equal to 1.
Greater than equal to 1, less than equal to 16.
16. And it's following root x, right? X to the power half. Okay. Comma. And when x is greater than 16, it is following the graph of x square by 64. Beautiful. Do you see that? Exact mirror image about y equal to x line. Exact mirror image about y equal to x line. So I'll draw that also to show complete this scenario. Okay. This is how you basically make the inverse of, or find the inverse of. Let me take a snapshot of this and put it on your notes. Okay. So this is how you find the inverse of a piecewise function. Where is it? Is this okay? Any questions here? Okay, I'll give you one more exercise just for you to try out, because obviously you would like to do one on your own. So let's say I have a function. I have a function which is defined as x plus 4 when x lies between 1 and 2, and is defined as 7 minus x when x lies between 5 and 6. Okay. Find the inverse of this function. That's one first part of it. And second is sketch both of them. So sketch f of x and its inverse. Everybody, please try this out. Just follow that process. You'll be able to find the answer without any problem. Just type done once you're done. So Dhyan has got it. Good, Dhyan. How about others? Ayush also done. Okay, let's discuss this. Not very difficult. So first thing that you would do is you write y as this. Okay, so I'll just copy my function. Remember step number one. Step number one is you are swapping the position of x and y. Step number two, you are making y the subject of the formula. So let me take one by one. So let me take the first piece of the function. So in first piece of the function, if you make
7 minus y.
Thank you. So in the first piece, if you make the change, you'll end up getting y as x minus 4. So this interval will also be for x minus 4. Just add a 4 to all the sides, so it will become 5 to 6. Okay. So this will be your function definition of inverse when you are between 5 to 6. Correct. Let's take the other one. So x is equal to 7 minus y. So y is equal to 7 minus x. And this definition will be true when 7 minus x lies between 5 and 6. Okay, do one thing, subtract 7 from all the sides, so it will become minus 2 to minus 1. Drop a negative sign and reverse their positions. Okay, so collating both these two informations, I can conclude that my inverse would be x minus 4 when x lies between 5 and 6, and it is 7 minus x when it lies between 1 and 2. Okay, now let us plot their graph, and very interesting thing will be seen over here. Please remember the function, okay, and its inverse. I'll ask you, okay. Can I go to GeoGebra now, or anybody who's copying from here? Copying done? Class? Copying part is in? Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. So now somebody please dictate me the function. So first tell me the interval and then the function definition. Okay. So I'm hiding this. Y is equal to if, yeah, tell me the first interval.
X between 1 and 2.
1 and 2, and it is defined as
x plus 4,
then 5 and 6, defined as
7 minus x.
Okay. So if you can see, I've actually zoomed in a lot. So I'll just zoom out from the given scenario. Okay, so you can see there are two line segments you can see here. Two minor line segment in blue. You see this, these two lines. Okay, so this is the graph of the original function. Now, what was the graph of its inverse?
It's between 5 and 6.
One second, 5 and 6. How is it defined?
X minus 4.
And then?
It's between 1 and 2, 7 minus x.
1 and 2, 7 minus x. Okay. Now see the green ones. How beautiful they are coming as crosses. Now this example is another example where you would realize that the function and its inverse don't even meet at all on y equal to x line. Isn't it? So this is a classic example where your function and its inverse are not even meeting on y equal to x line. They're meeting on their own positions. Okay. So this further, makes that property In fact, I will not call it as a property, but this is what many authors will state. So that further invalidates the fact. I'll plot it over here and keep. Okay. So just a concluding word over here before we go to some next set of problems. So this is an example where f of x and f inverse x do not intersect on y equal to x line. And there can be several such cases, right? There could be cases where they don't even meet at all. For example, e to the power x and ln x case. Now here is a case where they are meeting, but they're not meeting on y equal to x line. Is this fine? Oh, really? I'm terribly colorblind. Okay, so we'll conclude this idea of inverse with few problems which are going to be important not only for your JE but also for your schools. Okay, so let me give you a set of problems. We'll not solve all of them. Here I've selected few problems for you. Not all of them I'll do today. I'll just ask you to do the following. Do the first one. Do the third one. And do the seventh one. Okay. Rest you can do it for homework. And then we can actually start with our inverse trig functions. Our first one, if you're done, just write first done. Number one, done. So that I can discuss it. So assuming it is invertible, you don't have to prove it is invertible. Assuming it is invertible, assuming it's a bijection, find the inverse of this function. Done. Shaumik is done with the first one. Tripan also done. Vibhav also done. Okay. So this is a question which is a pakka question in your school exams also. Okay. So we'll discuss it. So y is equal to e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by e to the power x plus e to the power minus x plus 2. By the way, if you recall, it is actually tan hyperbolic x, dan plus 2 actually. Okay. This is just for your extra knowledge. Hello? Can you hear me? Can you hear me, everyone? Hello? Am I audible? Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry, there was a power cut and now it has come back. Okay. So, yes. So, this is just for your extra information. That is actually than x plus 2. Okay. Now, we have to make... Now, again, there are several approaches. Whether you want to swap x and y first and then make y the subject of the formula. Or you want to make x the subject of the formula and then swap x and y. So, let's say... First of all, I would write it like this, okay? And now I would be making x the subject of the formula. So if you make x the subject of the formula, you can use componendo and dividendo. So use componendo and dividendo. Okay? So when you use componendo and dividendo, first you can just add it on top. So it'll make y minus 1. And then you can subtract it from here. So it'll be 1 minus y minus 1. So it'll be 1 minus y plus 2. So that will be your e to the power x. Correct? Yes or no? So e to the power x is y minus 1 by 3 minus y. So x is ln of y minus 1 by 3 minus y. Now you can just swap the position of x and y from here. So this is what you will see. Okay, so this becomes your inverse of the given function. This becomes your inverse of the given function. Now, one thing that we can check here is that the range of this function will be the domain of this function. Okay, that I will verify for you over here. So let us find the range of this function. So what is the range of f of x? So for finding the range of f of x, you can take the limit of x tending to infinity of e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by e to the power x plus e to the power minus x plus 2. Now, all of you have done your limits, right? Can you evaluate this? So what do you do in this case first? You take e to the power x common, right? Something like this. E to the power x, e to the power x gone. And when x tends to infinity, remember these two terms will go for a toss. They'll become a zero. So answer will be 1 plus 2, which is 3. So this is the maximum value. Okay. And for minimum value, you have to take the limit when x tends to minus infinity. So when you apply the limit when x tends to minus infinity, in that case, what do you do? In that case, what do you do? Put y as minus x, isn't it? So when x tends to minus infinity, y tends to infinity. So it will be like e to the power minus y minus e to the power y by again e to the power minus y plus e to the power y. Correct? And do the same act that we had done in the previous limit. So we will take here e to the power y common. So we'll take e to the power y common. So it'll become e to the power minus 2y minus 1 by e to the power minus 2y plus 1. Okay. Plus 2 will remain as it is. This is gone. And now these terms will become 0. Don't ask why they become 0. Because that's a quantity whose modulus is less than 1. 1 by e is a quantity whose modulus is less than 1. So if you're raising it to an infinite power, it'll become 0. So your answer will be minus 1 plus 2, which is 1. So your range of the function is from 1 to 3. Now check the domain of the function over here. Check the domain of f inverse. So for domain of f inverse, you will say, since this is an argument of log, this guy must be greater than 0, right? Okay. Now, by the way, let me tell you one more thing. 1 and 3 cannot be achieved because infinities cannot be achieved. So they will be round brackets. Correct? Now, here if you solve this by wavy curve, this will be 1, this will be 3, and this will be negative, positive, negative. Check the sign scheme over here. Fine. Greater than 0 means it will be between 1 and 3. So this will be your domain of f inverse. So it further reestablishes that a function and its inverse, the domain and range position will be swapped. So domain of one will be the range of the other and vice versa. Got the point? Any questions here, anybody? So this is a question which will come for your, definitely come for your school exams as well. Please try the third one. And once you're done, please type done for the third one. If you want, I can take the question separately because we have almost used the entire space over here. So let me just put the question in the next sheet. So I'm taking your attendance right now. Hope everybody is present. Done. Third one is super easy. See, your function is x minus gif of x. Now, what is the domain of the function that you're looking at? Domain is from 2 to 3. You know, from 2 to 3, your gif is going to be 2. Correct? So this is your function. So anybody can find the inverse of it. What is it? X plus 2. Done. And remember, this will be valid when your x is between 0 and 1. So range will become the domain of its inverse. So please remember that. Fine. Try seventh one now. So this was your third one. So try seventh one now, everybody. So assuming that it's a bijection, look at the domain and the range. In fact, domain and range of f of x. We have to find the inverse of this function. So in the interest of time, I'll also start contributing over here. So first of all, we'll call this as y. Now we'll make x the subject of the formula. So for that, first you have to take log to the base of 2 on both the sides. So log y to the base 2 is x square minus 2x. So you can say it results into a quadratic. Right? Let us use the quadratic equation formula, the Sridhar Acharya formula over here, which is 2 plus minus under root b square minus 4ac, which is plus log y to the base 2. Whole divided by 2a. So I think the factor of 2 can be cancelled from everywhere. So it will become 1 plus log y to the base 2. Now, here there is a problem coming up. We have both plus and minus, but we cannot write both of them because we know inverse of a function is unique. I cannot write two answers for it. Now, which one do you think is accepted? Which of them is rejected? And why? Look at the domain. Domain says minus infinity to 1. So your x value should be less than 1.
Minus.
Right. So we'll take minus, not the plus. So in light of your domain, you choose one of the answers. This is very important. That's why I told the property that inverse is unique is very important. You cannot write plus minus both and say that this is your inverse. Now you can swap the position of x and y. Now when you swap the position of x and y, this is what you end up getting as your inverse. This is your answer. Okay. Any questions here? Anybody? So last half an hour, I'm going to now start your inverse trigonometry. But this was a useful and it was a much required exercise that we need to have. Probably while doing functions chapter, we can, you know, skip this part. Is that fine? And tomorrow, whatever is starting in your school, please message me privately, anybody, that this chapter has started in school. Fine. So that I am also prepared with respect to the next chapter. Yeah. So now we are going to start with inverse trigonometric functions. So Nafflers have already done this, and I'm sure they had a very good experience with this chapter, right? Skanda, Shankin, Anurag, say something. How did you find this chapter?
I've studied easier chapters.
Skanda, how was this chapter? How did you like overall? Tell your feedback to others.
I didn't like it that much, so.
Didn't like it that much. Okay. Anurag? Anurag is quiet. Okay. I don't believe that, it's a very easy chapter. Okay. So yeah, so what is this? Basically, this is a concept where you are learning the inverses of trigonometric functions. But wait a minute. Let me begin with the first trigonometric function, sine x, defined under this. Okay. Now under this function, under this definition, if you plot the graph of sine x, okay, you'd say, sir, wait a second. When I plot this function, I realize it's not a 1-1 function, because in the domain of the function, if you plot this graph, it is going to take so many turns. In other words, if I draw a horizontal line like this, it is going to cut the graph at millions and trillions and zillions of positions, right? So this is not a 1-1 function, correct? So because of this, it is not a 1-1 function. Okay, so 1-1. Okay. Now its range is from -1 to 1. Okay. But here the codomain is all real numbers, right? So it is not onto also. That means chapter over. We don't have to study inverse trigonometric function because it is not 1-1 and onto. So how can you find the inverse of it? Wish life were this easy for us, but it is actually not. So right now it is not 1-1 and onto, but you can definitely make it 1-1 and onto. Remember, this is what I was speaking in the inverse trigonometry chapter. So don't judge a function by its definition. Okay. If you curtail your domain and codomain in such a way that you don't allow it to take a turn, and secondly, you limit it between your range, then you will make this function an invertible function. You can make this function an invertible function, right? So agreed, in the present definition, we cannot find inverse. But what if I define my sine x function between two such points where I'm not allowing it to take a turn back? Now, I would ask from you, suggest me an interval where, number one, the function doesn't take a turn anywhere. Number two, it can cover all the values from -1 to 1. So basically, I'm asking you to treat this as your range. So what should be your domain such that your function doesn't take a turn and it covers all values from -1 to 1? What will you say?
-π/2 to π/2.
Okay. Now, there can be so many answers for it. Why not π/2 to 3π/2? Why not 3π/2 to 5π/2? And so on. See, all of them are accepted, but normally there is a standardization of the interval that we have done as a principal value branch. So normally we restrict our function to -π/2 to π/2 in this interval. Okay. So all the other parts will be removed off. So only in these two vertical lines, your function will not take a turn back. And if your function doesn't take a turn back in this interval, your function will be 1-1. Now, why not any other interval? Why was, you know, this standardization made? See, if you don't make this standardization, what will happen? Everybody will start making their own intervals. And then there would be an utter chaos when you are finding its inverse. All the rules will change. Dhyan has a question. Sir, could you please repeat from where you ruled out it being on to internet? Okay, fine. See, when I started talking about inverse trig function, I just draw the graph of sine x for its domain. And we realized that it was not 1-1 and onto. Correct? Then I told the class that even if it is not 1-1 and onto, we can make it 1-1 and onto. How? By restricting our domain and of course restricting our codomain. So codomain, I made it the range. So this became the range. So I made it onto. Okay. And how did I restrict my domain? I restricted my domain in such a way that I don't allow it to take a turn back. And secondly, it covers all the values in its range. Okay. So why not 0 to pi by 2? 0 to pi by 2 also it's 1-1, right? But it will not cover all the values in the range. So I want to go from minus 1 to 1. So it can only happen when I start from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, or pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2, or 3 pi by 2 to 5 pi by 2, or 5 pi by 2 to 7 pi by 2. But normally this branch is chosen as the principal value branch. Principal value branch. It's like your principal root. What is root of 4? What is root of 4? 2. Why not minus 2? Minus 2 is also correct. But why don't we write minus 2? Because 2 was considered as the principal root. So there has to be standardization in mathematics also, just like you have it in IUPAC names. Okay. So if you are studying trigonometry, you will have, if nothing is mentioned, this is the interval under which you are treating your sine x function to be 1-1 and onto. Right, unless until stated, this is the interval where you will be considering your function to be 1-1 and onto. Now there are other rules also which I would like to tell you in the beginning itself. Normally the interval that we choose, not only we ensure that the function is 1-1 there, the function the entire range of the function is taken care by that input set, but we also ensure that there is no discontinuity in the function in that particular interval. But this discontinuity criteria is not very important. Preferably we choose that interval where there is no discontinuity. But if there is a discontinuity coming up at the cost of making it 1-1, then we'll have to buy that discontinuity. Okay. So this is something that you should keep in mind. Later on we'll use this concept. So when you're writing the inverse of this function, you will write it like this. F inverse will be defined as domain is minus 1 to 1 and range is from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. This is very important. Unless until stated, your range and domain for sine inverse function, of course, there is nothing you can do with the domain. Okay, you can only curtail it between minus 1 to 1. So range cannot go beyond this. That's very, very important. Now, I'm just predicting hypothetically, if JE has to make this particular situation worse, or let's say JE advance and all, what they will say, that let's assume that there is a sine inverse function which is defined from minus 1 to 1 to pi by 2 to 3 pi by 2. Okay, then remember all the rules that you have learned. I'm just talking to the NAFLers. All the rules and properties that you have learned, they will all undergo a change. Okay, so whatever we are studying in this chapter is under the fact that I'm assuming that this is your domain of the inverse and this is the range of your inverse. Okay, is this fine? Any questions here? Now, how would their graph be related? Graph, you already know, if this is the graph of sine x under which it is invertible. So let me just draw here. This is minus pi by 2. I should actually draw it a little farther. let's say this is minus pi by 2. This is pi by 2. And this is 1. This is minus 1. Please note pi by 2 is a bigger value than 1 and minus 1, right? So don't draw it at the same levels. I've seen people making that mistake. So your graph would be like this. Okay. So this is the graph of sine x function. Now, if you want to take its inverse, what is the criteria for taking the inverse, drawing the inverse graph? You need to take the mirror image about y equal to x line. So let's say this is your y equal to x line. Okay. So if you draw the mirror image about this, let me draw it separately. Has it been done in Rajaji Nagar, this chapter?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Okay, so its graph will be like this. So whatever was on the x-axis will now jump and go on the y-axis. And whatever was on the y-axis will now come on the x-axis. So all of you, please carefully observe the shape. The shape will now become like this. Okay, so this is the shape of, it'll stop here, it'll not go any further. Okay, so the graph is only defined from minus 1 to 1 and range is only from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. The function for sine inverse on GeoGebra is arc sine. So I'll just type it for you. Y is equal to arc sine x. Okay, so this is the function. As you can see, this is the graph. Is this fine? This graph from now onwards should be in your mind. It is as good as knowing the graph of sine x itself. Now, a couple of things that I would like to comment about this graph. Is it monotonically increasing? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is always increasing. Now, this is something that you will learn in your application of derivatives. So if a function is monotonically increasing, okay, its inverse will also be monotonically increasing. Is that fine? Any questions here? And if a function is monotonically decreasing, its inverse will also be monotonically decreasing. So number one, couple of things that you have to note down here. The graph shows that sine inverse x is a monotonically, or you can say strictly increasing function. Now, what is a strictly increasing function? Many people ask me, sir, how mathematically should we understand strictly increasing function? It means that in sine inverse, if you put, let's say, if you put two inputs, x1 and x2, such that x1 is greater than x2, then sine inverse of x1 will also be greater than sine inverse of x2. This is a layman definition of an increasing function. Okay. And one more thing I would like to highlight over here. Inverses will always give you an answer as an angle in radians. Inverses will always give you an angle in radians. Is that fine? So if I ask you what is sine inverse half, what will the answer be?
Pi by 6.
Pi by 6. What is sine inverse root 3 by 2? Pi by 3. Okay. What is sine inverse minus half? Minus pi by 6. Okay. So always your answer would be angles mentioned in radians. Okay. Second thing that you would observe about this graph is symmetric about origin. This graph is symmetric about origin, which means sine inverse x is an odd function. Now, what is odd and even is something which is again a subject matter of functions chapter. I'll talk about it when the right time comes. Okay, so this is an analysis that I'm doing as of now for you. Fine. So sine inverse x is an odd function. Is this fine? Any questions here, anybody? Can you all hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. I think the power just went off again. Okay. Now, let's move on without much ado to cos inverse. Let's move on to cos inverse. So now when you're studying cos inverse, again, I'll save your time over here. In order to make it onto, we have to keep it as the range of the function. Now cos inverse graph, cos x graph is again a sinusoidal curve like this. Okay, is again a sinusoidal curve like this. So in which interval do you suggest me to break this graph so that it is one function? And it covers the entire range from -1 to 1.
0 to π.
0 to π. That's excellent. Okay. You could have written π to 2π, 2π to 3π, 3π to 4π, 0 to -π. All those are acceptable, but normally we stick to this interval as our PVB. What is PVB? Principal value branch. Okay. So under this definition, yes, cos x is a invertible function. Correct. So graphically speaking, we only consider this part of our function to be invertible. Fine. So its inverse would be having a domain of -1 to 1 and a range from 0 to π. And it is written as cos inverse of x. Okay. Now, how would the graph look like? So for the graph, you have to reflect this graph about y equal to x line. Y equal to x line. Now, everybody, I would request you all to draw the graph of its inverse on your notebooks. Then I will sketch the final graph here. Now, people who attended the bridge course, actually, I told you a method how to reflect a graph about y equal to x line. Now, many a times we find it very difficult to imagine the reflection. You have to be artistically very good in order to imagine the reflection. Okay. So in such cases, normally I tell this approach, method to find or method to reflect a graph of a function about y equal to x line. The method is, first reflect the graph about the x-axis. First reflect the graph about the x-axis. Okay, so this graph, I'll just draw a miniature one so that doesn't take much of a time. So if you reflect it about, if you reflect this about x-axis, how will it look? It will look like this, correct, roughly, okay. Second step is, what is second step? Rotate it.
90 degrees
anti-clockwise, correct? So you just rotate this by 90 degree anti-clockwise. That means make the x-axis as the y-axis and make y-axis as the negative x-axis. So if you reflect it, this is what you are going to see. Okay. So the graph of inverse of cos is going to be like this. All of you please pay attention. This is one. This will go like this. Okay, so this point will be at pi. This point is π/2. This point will be at -1. Let me just disconnect it over here, else. Yeah. Is this fine? So I'll show this on the GeoGebra tool as well. So the function for this is arc cos x. Do you see this graph? Okay. Now cos was a decreasing function. cos was the decreasing function here. See, it is a decreasing function, monotonically decreasing, you can say. So its inverse is also a decreasing function. So its inverse is also a decreasing function. Correct? Agreed? So two things that we need to know. Number one, cos inverse x is a strictly decreasing function. Is a strictly decreasing function. What does it mean? If x1 is greater than x2, then cos inverse x1 will be what sign should I put over here?
Less
than, absolutely. Very important. Second thing, many people have this misconception that because cos is the function cos is a symmetric function about y-axis, that means it is an even function. So cos inverse x should also be an even function. The answer is no. Cos inverse x is neither even nor odd. Neither even nor odd function. Is that fine? One question let me ask you here. What is the value of cos inverse minus half?
Minus pi by 3.
Yeah, that's the mistake I was expecting. Your answer cannot exceed this interval. Your answer should be only in 0 to pi interval. That is the whole point of discussing this. You cannot have, first of all, minus pi by 3 also is wrong. But you cannot give any answer which is beyond 0 to pi. So only one answer is possible for this. This is 2 pi by 3.
2 pi.
Got it? So why are these intervals given? Is because by mistake also you should not mention anything beyond that particular interval. Is this understood? Any question here? Okay. So let me ask you a small question over here. I'll not teach you much because we can take it fresh in the next class. Okay. This is something which I thought I would ask you. Solve for the interval of x where cos inverse x will be greater than cos inverse x square. Done? Just type done once you're done. Very good, Tripan. Can you move upward? Okay. This place, Ananya? Okay, now this could be solved by use of this particular information that cos inverse x is a decreasing function. So these are arguments for cos inverse. So if cos inverse x is greater than cos inverse x square, it means x has to be less than x square, correct? Which means you're trying to solve x square minus x is greater than 0, which means you're trying to solve this. You can easily solve it by wavy curve. So if you make a wavy curve, Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah. So I made a wavy curve out of it. So 0 and 1 are your two zeros of these polynomial, plus, minus, plus. So greater than 0 will be from minus infinity to 0 and 1 to infinity. So this is the interval in which you're... Now, when many people write this answer, they forget the fact that you cannot mention anything which is not in the domain of these functions. Right? I think this is the mistake done by Tripan also. Tripan? Can you hear me, Tripan? Okay. So you cannot state anything which is greater than, you know, one in this, because these functions cannot work for any input which is greater than one. So please do not blindly solve this. You can only include from minus one to zero, my dear. So only in this interval you can say this condition will hold good. Right? So the whole intent of giving you all these domain and range is that you should not state anything beyond it. Domain and range are your Lakshman Rekha. Try to get this. Don't try to, you know, cross Lakshman Rekha, right? You saw what happened to Ravan, right? So please do not give your answer which will make any function involved undefined. So this is your answer, my dear. I knew people would make this mistake. Okay. So let us, in the 5 minutes, we can take the graph of the function tan inverse also. So now I will not write anything. I'll just draw the graph of tan inverse. You decide under which interval you should take for the function to be 1, 1 and onto. My graphs are so crooked nowadays. Yeah. So this will be at pi by 2. This will be at minus pi by 2. One more I'll draw. Okay. This will be pi. This will be 3 pi by 2. Okay. Now, of course, it is not 1, 1 in the present format. So where do you intend to take its interval so that it is 1, 1? Of course, range is all real numbers. So what is the suggested domain? Now there could be two answers. One group of people will say from 0 to pi, excluding pi by 2. Now that is not wrong, but that is not preferred. The reason being, there is a discontinuity coming at pi by 2, right? So what did I tell you in the initial part of choosing the domain where it is 1, 1? We must choose it preferably as that where there is no discontinuity. So if an option is there to take a non-discontinuous interval, we should go for it. Okay. So here we have an option by choosing minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 open. Okay. So this part of the graph, we'll have to say thank you very much. This is not required. So only from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, you will consider this function to be 1, 1. And of course, in this interval, you'll take it as onto. Okay. Now, how would you define its inverse? Inverse would be defined as the domain is all real numbers. See, I'm pronouncing these words. Domain is all real numbers. That means you can feed anything to tan inverse. Range is from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. That means your answer will only be from minus 90 to 90 or minus pi by 2 to pi by 2. Okay. And it is written as tan inverse of x. How would the graph look like? I'm sure now you are expert in drawing the graph. So first, reflect it about x-axis, rotate it 90 degree anti-clockwise, or reflect it about y-axis, rotate it 90 degree clockwise. Both will give you the same result. Okay. So in the interest of time, let me draw it. Please note this graph will never be able to touch, pi by 2. So pi by 2 and minus pi by 2 line will be asymptotic. Okay, so range domain is all real numbers, so you can see it extending from minus infinity to infinity. Range is from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, excluding both the endpoints. Okay, so few observations here. Number one, y is equal to pi by 2 and y is equal to minus pi by 2 are asymptotes to this graph. Fine. Second observation is tan inverse x function is monotonically increasing. Okay. That means if you put x1 greater than x2, even your tan inverse x1 would be greater than tan inverse x2. Okay. Third thing that you would observe that this function is an odd function because it is symmetrical about origin. So that makes this function an odd function. So there are some even odd properties also. We'll talk about them in later part of the chapter. Okay. So fine, we'll stop here. There are three more functions left, and of course, numerous properties are coming your way. So almost 10-14 properties are there which we have to talk about. So next class full will go into this, and next to next class also full will go into this. Okay. So fine, let us stop here. Thank you so much, and keep me updated about the chapter that is going to be taken up in the school tomorrow. And all the best, NPS RNR. Okay, your screen time is going to increase though, but I'm sure this is the year where you have to face the brunt. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye, sir.
Thank you, sir.